Yeah. Draft day, Johnny Manziel. 5 years later, how am I the man still? Draft day, A. Wiggins. That other side, we stay winning. Oh man, you know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Yeah. Suits and ties yelling out, pay the guys, man, I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Oh man, oh man, oh man, man, you know I had.
Welcome back to the Racial Draft Podcast. I am your host, Michael Ford, and joining me this week, the Jeff Morales to my Miguel O'Hara, Carlos Freitas.
Jr. I don't even know what that means. You're going to, never mind. I don't want to get into spoilers.
I mean, I'm just here lording over the multiverse, trying to make sure things go according to plan, and, you know, and you're the popo.
Yeah, right. Wow. Okay. All right. That's fair, I guess.
I mean, you also are also the dad of you're very much the dad of the racial draft.
I am a father to two half Puerto Rican children. So
yeah, you see, there you go.
I guess we have more in common than I realized.
But yes, we are here doing what we do every week, and that is change the complexion of the comic book universe one draft pick at a time. But before we change the complexion of the comic book universe, we got to talk a little non-spoiler. It is Spider-Verse weekend. We are not beyond the Spider-Verse. We are across the Spider-Verse. I assume you did see this movie this weekend. I assume you are recommending that our listeners also see this movie this weekend. Is that correct, Carlos?
Oh, I was there Thursday, 4 p.m., which I should have been working, but I was like, no, I bought these tickets. I'm picking up my kids. We're running across town to the movie theater to get there, and it was a packed theater at 4 p.m. on a Thursday, which I haven't seen in a long time, and the movie was, my kids and I were talking about, we've been waiting for 4.5 years for this, and it delivered everything we wanted and more. Jaw-dropping moments that honestly, like, weren't even necessarily plot related, just like stuff that I was on this show, and I was talking about how there was a moment in the first Spider-Verse where, had there been a Puerto Rican in the room, Miles would have said bendición to his mom before he left, you know, for his school that first mm-hmm. segment of the film. Like, had there been a Puerto Rican in the writer's room, they would have been like, no, he needs to say bendición and she needs to say que Dios te bendiga. And it happens in this movie. Spoilers. He says bendición to his mom. Like, and my kids and I were just like, oh, he did it. He did the thing. And so even just that was jaw-dropping. And then, but just the most beautiful movie. Like, it's gorgeous. It's fantastic. And I've been recommending it to everyone.
Yeah. I mean, I'm definitely going to see it at least one, probably four more times before it's no longer in the theaters. And that brings us right into our first news story, which is that at least in the US, it is now, depending on how you slice it, the biggest 3-day opening of the year.
Oh wow.
The 5-day open for Super Mario was bigger, but as far as 3-day openings go, as far as opening days go for a film this year, it's the number one with let me find it. What's that number? What is that number? 51.7 million in its first day.
Wow.
So, internationally, it was a little bit down. You know, the splits are at this point 120-ish, a little over domestically, and 88 worldwide. Or sorry, 88 overseas. So, you know, getting us a little bit under 210 worldwide.
So, I mean, listen, anytime in animated or live action, where your main character is black, I usually just look at like, we're going to have to do the heavy lifting on this one, guys.
unless, you know, unless we're talking about Black Suit Venom, then all of a sudden.
Oh, well, that's a little different. Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah, right.
Yeah, but any other thing, any others. And that's why, I mean, they probably thought about the Black Widow movie. They were like, All Widow? All Widow?
I mean, I remember I guess I would have been like a teenager, but learning that like Will Smith was not the box office draw internationally that he was here. Because for a while, Will Smith was like the king of summer. He put out movie, like it was like Harrison Ford. Then it was, you know, like the baton was passed to Tom Cruise. This used to be a thing people tracked, like who was the king of summer. And then it went to Will Smith for a while.
And Will had basically like the algorithm. He was like ahead of the curve. You know, he was like, these are the kinds of movies that make the most money. These are the kind of movies I need to get in and they need to come out this time of year.
Yeah.
So that I can maximize my exposure.
Right. And I mean, and it failed him a couple times. Like he didn't take The Matrix and he did take Wild Wild West, you know, like things like that. But for the most part, starting with like Enemy of the State, Men in Black, you know, Bad Boys, like those, he was the king of summer, but only here. He wasn't.
Not to mention Independence Day.
Now, of course, yeah. Yeah, but I remember learning like, wait, he's not the same, he's not huge everywhere, and I mean obviously he's still a star, but he was not the lock that he was, and ever since then, so this has been, you know, two-thirds of my life I've just kind of known, got a black lead in your movie.
Yeah, for Erica's me it was
the heavy lifting.
For me it was harder to stomach finding out that it was Denzel that didn't have like any global appeal. I was like, what? What the hell is wrong with the world?
Yeah.
You know? It was that when he did the the Equalizer, and that was like his highest box office overseas. I was like, oh, okay, I get it. This is what you gotta do. He's basically got to pull a Taken.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
All right, Liam, you win. You win this time. Liam. We'll get into it. We might as well. We talked a little bit about its opening night. We talked about, we'll stay in the Spider-Verse conversation because, Sony's feeling themselves right now. They are doing big talk. Avi Arad's got his name all. I think it's the last name you see on the credits. It's like, yeah, I did that shit. I don't know if you heard this, but he's been given credit for the spot being chosen as the villain.
Oh,
in this movie, apparently Lord and Miller, when they were working on the script, apparently Avi Arad poked his head in there in the little office and said, hey, why don't you guys use a spot? And they were like, a spot? He's a joke. And they're like, wait a second.
Yeah.
Ah.
Interesting.
You know? So, but...
I dug the spot in this movie, I gotta say.
Well, yeah, I mean, we'll get into it if we may do a special spoiler episode. So stay tuned for that. But yeah, the spot was spot on, as it were. But additionally, they are continuing their belief that they can do no wrong when it comes to spider related projects. So they have said it's all on the table. It's all coming. We're getting it all. Live action Miles Morales, live action Gwen Stacy, more Spider-Woman. Are you psyched on a scale of 1 to 616? How psyched are you for live action versions of the characters in the Spider-Verse?
I would say that I'd need more information from Sony before I could get psyched. You know, like if it's like Sony's doing it and Kevin Feige's not involved and Lord and Miller are not involved, then I am honestly not that psyched. But if at least Lord and Miller are involved, or someone from Spider-Verse, I should say, like it doesn't have to be Lord and Miller.
I like Lord and Miller from a writing side.
Sure.
I don't need them to direct it. but it really does feel like the, you know, not to, again, we're not going to get into spoilers right now, but it really does seem like they've managed to wrap their arms around this property conceptually in a way that almost makes you forgive the shitty live action movies. You know, and remember, they are executive producing and in kind of in control of the TV shows, the Spider, which are like Silk, you know, that are in development. So, you know, I'm fine with them being kind of like the Kevin Feige of this property, if they're truly empowered and they and those executives, you know, barring an occasional poke your head in and say, hey, would you like to use a spot in this book?
Yeah.
You know, but if they're the final, if they're getting the final word, I would feel a lot more positive about them bringing all of these characters to live action.
They have an almost and not almost, it's equal to James Gunnian ability to take what sounds like bad ideas and make them into great movies. Like 21 Jump Street, when they announced that was going to be a movie, it's not like, oh, are we really like part of this trend of like doing these kind of deconstructed reimaginings of like 70s and 80s TV. And 21 Jump Street is one of the funniest movies I've ever seen in my life. Yeah. Like, it's,
you know,
so
I've still good. Never seen it. One of these days. I gotta.
It's
take
so funny out. And it's so smart. Like when I was watching it, I remember going like, "Oh, I see how this is gonna go." And then it like completely flips the paradigm. You're like, "Oh, this is actually kind of brilliant." The Lego Movie. Mm-hmm. Like now we consider the Lego Movie a classic, but like when it was announced, it's like, what are we doing? Like, like, have you really run out of ideas? The Lego Movie is fantastic. Lord and Miller have this ability to take misfit ideas and make a great story from them. Yeah. So, like, if you
which is why it was so obvious that they should have gotten the Han Solo movie. That's why I made so much. That's why it made so much sense to put one of the most precious IPs with the most orthodox fan base.
Exactly.
Who wants nothing to change.
Right.
From there. That's why they're a natural fit.
Totally. Match made in heaven. Yeah. but Lord and Miller, like if you told me that they were the ones producing, not even writing necessarily, but they just kind of had an eye on that the Donald Glover hypno hustler movie, like which sounds awful. Like, yeah, okay. I'm in. I want to see that now.
El Muerto.
Exactly.
Chris and Miller. Perfect
example. Yeah.
I mean, sorry, Lord and Miller.
But like, but with, you know, with Miles Morales, like I just want to know that someone who cares enough to have been a part of the making of Spider-Verse. And like I said, it doesn't have to be Lord and Miller, but I can't remember the name of the director.
Kemp Powers. There were three. Kemp Powers was one, who you might know from Soul. And the other two. Wait for it.
I can't believe I don't remember their names now.
I mean, Kemp Powers was the only one whose name I recognized. So that's on me.
Yeah.
Joaquin Dos Santos and Justin Thompson, Justin K. Thompson.
Okay. So let's say any of those three guys wanted to make a live action Miles Morales movie. Like, okay. Cool. Like you've earned it. You've earned that that spot, you know.
I would worry
from Sony is what I'm saying.
I would worry that if strong creative hands like Lord and Miller weren't there to put themselves between Amy Pascal and and Avi Arad, that it would turn into one of those kinds of movies where it's like we have notes.
Right. Yeah. In this imagining, the electricity in Miles's body can talk to him and it is voiced by another performance from the same Miles Morales actor. And
in this season, can we make him a couple hues lighter? Can we just turn that dial up a little bit?
Woody Harrelson plays Uncle Aaron, and exactly. Yeah. I just need to know more from Sony before I make that decision if I'm excited or not. And even once I do hear more from Sony. Then it becomes like, okay, who are you getting to play Miles? Because this is tricky. Because every article you've seen that's like, actors who could play Miles Morales are either 30-year-old Afro-Latinos, like Jarrell Jerome. Guys, yeah, Jarrell Jerome, great actor. He's 27 years old. Like, what do you want? Yes. And or there are people who are not Latino at all, and so it's just like it just
again
just, yeah there are a lot
this
of
is
things.
Something this is something that I talk about a lot, and we'll bring it up again whenever we're doing these teen heroes. We have to remember that time is of the essence.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you gotta get the movie made, you gotta bang out your sequels, or you gotta cast someone who you're sure is not gonna age, and guess, and you know, not to stereotype, but but very often, just because black doesn't crack does not mean that black does not age. You right. will cast yourself a 13-year-old, and when he's 14, he's 6'2".
Yeah, like, right. Exactly. Like,
oh shit.
Yeah. Well, what was the kid on Lost?
Yeah, the like... guy who right, the guy who played Walt.
Walt.
He's like, hey, Dad.
Yeah.
It's only been 20 days. Walt.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Why did you go through all of puberty?
Yeah. Yeah. And by you know, all chances are that the perfect actor for Miles Morales is currently 10 years old. Like, we just don't know. We don't know who that person is.
And at least with voice casting, you know, these actors can age, but they're, you know, they can figure out how to do the vocal performance.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't notice it. Like Shameik Moore, like you said, Shameik Moore, I think, is 27 or 28.
Probably. Yeah, that's about right. Know?
But, you know, the 5 years that it took between the last Spider-Verse and this Spider-Verse, that would be enough to destroy of the... I mean, we just saw it. I mean, not the same thing exactly, but we just saw with Shazam Fury of the Gods. You know, when those kid actors came back like 3 years later looking like adults.
Right. Yeah, where suddenly Zachary Levi's playing the much older version of a kid who's already 18.
Right. I mean, yeah, he was 18, but the actor was like 24.
Right, exactly. Yeah, it's like, shouldn't he just be playing the Shazamified version of himself?
Yeah, go the other way. You CGI him as a kid. Get all the leftover footage from the last movie.
Right. and then Zachary Levi's playing like a 12-year-old version of an 18-year-old character. Like,
right.
It was rough.
It's one of the things that broke the movie. Yeah. It's like, you're more mature before you say Shazam.
Right.
That's not how that's supposed to work.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, so that, you know, but so Sony's feeling good, and I mean, right now you even got people saying, oh man, maybe Tom Holland needs to, you know, start doing his movies under the auspices of Sony alone. And I say, be careful what you wish for, people. Simmer down. In 6 months, we'll be here talking about Kraven the Hunter, and I want to hear that same energy.
You're right, exactly. You know, I wouldn't mind, I guess, necessarily if you told me Sony was building up to a Spider event movie or something, and that it involved Tom Holland. It wouldn't like kill me if it involved Tom Holland. But yeah, somehow so, no, it needs to involve Tom Holland, involving, but not the MCU.
Right. That's what I mean. Like, involving Tom Holland is one thing. Them saying we don't need Marvel anymore.
Right.
And we are going to carry the torch of whatever follows with Tom Holland Spider-Man. I don't know. No, we don't.
Again, if Sony put Lord and Miller in charge of their Spider-Verse... If they made them the Feigies of their Spider-Verse, and
even
everything
then, though, even then, everything... because then there are so many other Spider characters that I would feel more comfortable and trusting in term, you know, because those characters, they can start from scratch. They wouldn't, you know, in the case of Holland Spidey, he's been established in the MCU. It's so enmeshed in that version of the character, even with the Doctor Strange shenanigans.
Sure.
That it would be like, oh, so now what, that the whole Thanos thing that didn't happen? No,
You would just, you know? I mean, it would basically just have to be an agreement where, like, he still exists in the MCU, but you just do not have MCU characters showing up in his movies the same way. You know, like, he doesn't have a, you know, Doctor Strange isn't there for half the movie or whatever.
Yeah.
But he exists in a world where Doctor Strange exists.
Yeah, but after a while you would feel that absence.
Probably.
Yeah. And it just wouldn't be to the benefit of that property when you could just do that with other characters who are canonically in a different universe.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Andrew Garfield. Yeah.
Exactly. Or
I'd watch it all day long.
Yeah, a lot of us would.
I love that Spider-Man and always have, and I'm so happy that everyone agrees now.
Yeah, I mean, it was not his fault that the movies weren't up to par. If he had been it remains my opinion that if they had just ported him over into the MCU and said some, oh yeah, yeah, no, you know, you were always the Peter Parker of this universe. Like we would have accepted it and we would have been happy. I mean, now granted, the relationship with him and Tony Stark wouldn't have been the same.
Right.
But I think he would have been perfectly fine alongside the rest of the MCU. He would have been loved and probably would have had a $1 billion movie.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, it would have been substitute teacher. It would have been substitute teacher Peter Parker in Brooklyn Visions Academy.
Right.
What if Miles Morales?
Right.
But but listen, I'm happy. We're definitely not gonna stop talking about this movie. And we need to find out I know why we're not gonna find out, but we need to find out immediately when this thing is dropping on streaming so that I can plan yes. a day off just to watch this movie as soon as it drops.
Yeah, and this is going to be one that I'm going to own on physical media for sure. You know, like, I'm definitely going to have it so that I never have to be like, where is it streaming? Which I have to do with Into the Spider-Verse so often. Even though I have a physical copy, the physical copy is in storage. And so, yeah, like, I have to find where it's streaming. And, it, you know, it's on Netflix and then it's not. And then, it, you know, like, I got to rent it through Amazon.
So I think the current deal. Right. So I think the current deal is, you know, Netflix first window, Disney Plus from that point forward.
Okay.
So it should be on Disney Plus now. I haven't checked the original one. And, you know, honestly, good on them if they've managed to make the long-term home of all of the Spider-Verse movies, Disney Plus, because... Yeah. No spoilers for this movie, but this movie makes you want to kind of go and revisit those other movies.
For real. Yeah. Makes you want to revisit the cartoons. Makes you want to revisit everything. Yeah.
Right. So very, very smart business on the part of Sony and Marvel. I mean, you don't always say that.
Yeah.
You know, staying in the business realm, but going from really good to really bad. Well, depending on how you look at it, I suppose. The Thunderbolts has been halted. You know, there's a thing called a writer's strike. We've been dancing around it. So these productions that are contingent on there being a story, that's weird, right? A story having to be written for a movie. But so some of these projects, which are known for their extensive late stage rewrites, are not going into production as planned. And one of those is the Thunderbolts. We don't have a date because we don't know when the strike is going to end.
Mm-hmm.
So stay tuned on that front. Speaking of stories that have not been written, there are rumors that the Vision Quest show will feature Viv and Vin Vision. You have any thoughts about that?
My thoughts are that it feels so far away that I'm not, like, it's not on my radar until, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? Let's get through the slate that you actually announced.
Fair enough. Before,
you know, like, because of the way that they've slowed down the conveyor belt,
who knows?
Are we talking about something that's coming up 10 years from now? Like, I don't know what your plan is to release this, you know? Is it a special? Like, I don't know. So
see,
it's just not like not registering for me yet as to like being on my radar.
See, I only like this because it fits in the realm of what my theory of Vision Quest is basically WandaVision in reverse.
Right.
You know, where it's like now it's Vision with a simulation or a simulacrum of a family.
Yeah.
And instead of TV based, it's techno based. Mm-hmm. So him having his kids, Vin and Viv, as his stand-ins, you know, for the family that he wants, would be a nice kind of companion piece. No, but you're right. 2027, 2029.
Right.
Who knows?
Yeah. I have no clue. Yeah.
So, we'll find out next week that Vision Quest has also been delayed, due to there not being a story.
Yeah, you can't spitball a story without spitballers. So,
exactly. But this is going to be a lot. You're going to see this theme again as we jump from Marvel to DC, because there's a movie called Superman Legacy that is being written, but not being written by James Gunn, who is currently on strike. But he's also the head of a studio. So even though he's not writing, he's thinking about the movie. So there was a story that came out this week that added a new name. Someone new has stepped into the Superman casting discussion. I don't know this person. All I know is that he is a model. He is a very attractive man. His name is Pearson Foday. Have you seen these pictures going around, Carlos?
Was this the guy that's from The Bold and the Beautiful? Or
that is the guy from The Bold and the Beautiful.
Yeah.
I'm guessing he's not The Bold. I'm going to go out and say, I'm going to come right out and say it. I think he's a little bit too hot to be Superman. Like, a little too hot to be Superman. Like, okay. I think that, like, Superman should be an attractive man. I'm not saying he shouldn't.
Right.
But I think that glasses aren't going to be enough. Glasses aren't going to be enough for you not to be like, yeah, that guy. That guy.
Right, right. Okay.
You know?
That's fair.
You got to be you got to have a look that's a little bit too generic. Like, you'd be really good looking, but you'd be good looking in a way that like 100 other guys are good looking.
Right. Yes.
You know?
Yeah. The term all American comes to mind. You've got to look like all American. Not just like, not just like a few American.
Right. It's like generally speaking, like, unless you're a Abercrombie model. Like, this is more like runway model than Abercrombie model. So we have been joined by our guy, Randy. Who is Randy? I guess Randy is the Jessica Drew to my Miguel O'Hara coming in on the motorcycle with the baby.
It says Randy's connecting to audio. Randy didn't hear any of that. Randy was connecting to audio the entire time.
Randy, can you hear us?
I can, yes.
All right.
So you missed the introduction. That's probably for the best. Fine.
Hopefully, while I'm missing out on the introduction, hopefully y'all are missing out on my video because I look ridiculous right now.
We're not missing out on your video.
I mean, you know what? I'm changing it up right. You are the Hobie Brown to my Miguel O'Hara. Right? Okay. Now you just have to hit us with the accent real quick.
Maybe as a special treat toward the end.
Okay, fair enough. But just so you know, just to bring you up to speed real quick, we were talking about the rumored new entrant into the Clark Kent sweepstakes, Bold and the Beautiful star Pearson Foday.
Mm-hmm.
And I put it out there. I think he's too hot to be Clark Kent.
Yeah, same. Like he's too pretty boy model type looking. I couldn't imagine him being like, even with like being invulnerable and all of that stuff, I can't like look at him and be like, yeah, that's farm boy. Like, no.
Well, I mean, even putting aside the farm boy aspect, like, he's supposed to be a reporter, Like, yes. You throw glasses on him and you're still like, you're a model wearing glasses, right, sir?
Okay, sure, Clark Kent, sure.
Yeah, it's like, it's giving, did somebody order reporting? Bachelorette party, right, vibes. Exactly.
His bylines are like, by Clark Kent, wink, wink.
Right. No, so yeah, we're that's a no for me, dog. Yeah. Like, but very, very attractive man, very attractive man for sure. I don't know anything about his acting. Moving on from one implausible superhero universe to another, Fast and the Furious news. Yes, yes, Fast and the Furious news. It would appear that the legendary lawman, Luke Hobbs, is riding, is saddling up one more time in the middle, I guess, middle layer of the Fast X sandwich. Is that what we want to call it? The, you know, the meaty filling, the beefy filling of the Fast X chopped cheese. And yeah, The Rock is going to give us all the cheese and all the chop. How did you feel when you got the news that Dwayne Johnson was coming back to the Fast franchise, Randy?
I'm not a Fast and Furious fan, but I do think it's pretty funny because it was like it's very very publicly they had a falling out, and he was like, you know, him and Vin Diesel going back and forth and saying all of their whatevers back and forth, and it's just like, After he changed the hierarchy of the, I mean, he changed the hierarchy, probably not for the best, but now he's kind of coming back, you know, I guess with his tail between his legs, or you know, whatever The Rock's pride will allow the equivalent of that to be. I mean, good for him, I guess.
But I also feel like, you know, it's not like the Fast and the Furious is currently riding high, to, you know, to the extent that it feels like, I got to get back on this in this winning situation. You know, I think when
I say that, I guess it's less a matter of like getting back to the winning situation as so much as like getting back to the thing that I know is stable. It's going to keep going like ad infinitum. We're going to be. Yeah. In our like decades from now, like faster and furiouser beyond, it's gonna constantly keep going until they can't go anymore.
Yeah. What about you, Carlos?
I think that they need each other, yeah. Oddly, and I have started calling The Rock. I refer to him as MODOK. But instead of MODOK, it's MODOCH. He's the mechanized organism designed only for changing hierarchies. Nice. So yeah, I think, you know,
I mean, he did change the hierarchy of power in the Fast franchise at one point.
He did. But I think that the Fast universe is the thing that's coming. Like, they're going, you know, they're supposedly working on an all female character, yes, film. And, you know, I'm sure there's going to be Fast and Furious Babies, Saturday morning cartoon.
Sure.
And, you know, like one that's just, yes, one cartoon that's just their cars talking.
It's going to,
you know,
be like just, it's going to be like the teens. It's going to be like quick and ill tempered.
We riding bikes really fast.
Yeah. You know, and it'll, you know, it'll be like, I wish I had another character's name from this like franchise, because I am not a Fast and Furious person.
Oh, you see, but there will be like the only one. Yeah,
yeah, there will be an equivalent of like.
Now I'm thinking about the old people version. It's going to be like slow and ill-tempered, ill-mannered. Like,
it's going to be like,
it's grumpy. It's crossing over with a grumpy old man.
Exactly. And there will be like a, you know, their version of Alfred, the origin of Dom Toretto's mechanic, or something.
Yes, yes.
That's
what I was looking for. I was looking for the like 100-year prequel of like Dom Toretto's grandfather driving around in like the early 20th century.
Oh my god, please let there be a
prohibition.
Let there be a Toretto verse where like there's race, you know, horse racing, drag horse racing, robbing coaches and banks.
Fast with stagecoaches,
and they still go to space in a coach with horses. I'm in.
Sign me up for the Fastiverse, all of the variants, all of the multiversal incarnations.
I'm really surprised that there isn't like a big video game franchise. Like there, I'm sure there have been video games. I'm sure that there are video games, but like the fact that there isn't a universe of like GTA kind of knockoffs of the Fast and the Furious seems wild with that many characters and it's driving. Like you're driving.
You're doing so much more than driving.
this submarine into that T-Rex. Randy.
I was just about to say, like, have we taken the vote of like whether we want Fast and Furious crossovers with like Jurassic Park or Back to the Future? Like, have we taken our vote on that yet?
I have an open poll right now on Twitter, so I'm going to plug that right now. It's Fast to the Future, where they drive back to 1955 and race Klansmen. And then there's also Fastific Rim, where they're in Jaegers fighting Kaijus. So those are my top two.
I put me in for the write-in vote of Jurassic Park. They are racing to try to defeat the dinosaurs for some reason.
Now, are they riding dinosaurs or are they racing dinosaurs?
Yes. I feel like they're riding dinosaurs and they're also racing dinosaurs.
I mean, can't you just see the scene where they like, you know, Dom looks over and then there's like Tyrese looks over and then there's like a velociraptor looks over and then like I see, and I'm going a fourth direction. Okay. Give me Pride and Furious. I think we need to. I think we need to open up to the ladies and let's get some Keira Knightley.
I'm so mad
Victorian
that I
English.
Understood what you were talking about as soon as you said that.
Pride and Furious and zombies, even that could be great. let's do it. Let's just have all of the things. But honestly, like it's amazing that there isn't. Although maybe they're
Furious of the Caribbean. They're pirate times. I mean, on the high seas.
We didn't know that there was a spinoff coming with Mad Max, right? Fast and Furiosa. It's been right there for
us. It's been there.
The Max and the Mad. Exactly.
I mean, it's even got Charlize in it, you know.
The Fast and Furious case of Benjamin Button. There are so many. But no, there should be cartoons. There should be video games. There should be all of this stuff, and they should just expand it out as far as you can. Because the fact that this is all relying on Vin Diesel should be the scariest thing in Hollywood.
Right.
Like it just should be.
Right, and that's why I'm happy that The Rock is back, because you know, I mean, we don't have to get into the rumors that he's beefing, that Vin Diesel's beefing with Jason Momoa, but shocked if that's true. Shocked
right.
That Vin Diesel might feel threatened by a bigger star.
Look, if you are worried that somebody is stealing your thunder, perhaps make your thunder harder to steal. That's all I will say about that.
If I could offer a basketball equivalent, and it's kind of timely, Vin Diesel is like the Jimmy Butler of franchises, like a franchise actors, because he's like not quite as good as The Rock, or as your other, like, but
I don't like this metaphor. No, you see, this is you as a Bulls fan, not
it's
as
not
a
like
fan.
I don't yeah. like Jimmy
this
Butler.
Is no, that's Jimmy Butler when he played for the Bulls, because Jimmy Butler in the Heat is in the finals, right?
The thing about Jimmy Butler is the teams he's on, and watch them now win the next three games, but the teams he's on will never win because he's the best player on them, yes. but he cannot play with players who are better than him. It pisses him off.
That
and
is fair.
So that I think fair. Vin, that there's the Vin Diesel, like Vin Diesel no, is but this, good enough to headline a franchise, but yeah. he cannot play with a kid even the same size as okay. him, let's even say.
So this is where it's going to pain me, because I don't believe this, but I feel like for the purposes of the metaphor, I have to say what I'm about to say. There's a basketball player named Kevin Durant.
Yeah.
He joined a franchise, and that franchise became really great when another star, when yeah. he joined up with another star, then he left to start his own franchise. And then he started to look around for other stars.
Kevin Durant, also great at changing hierarchies. Excellent at changing hierarchies. I think we've done it. But yeah, so, I mean, the thing is, if Kevin Durant ever ended up on the Heat, automatically they'd win the next three championships. But Kevin Durant and Jimmy Butler just could not possibly. And that's what I'm saying about the past, just to be clear,
we are getting a Fast to the Future, yeah. Jurassic Park.
Yep.
the Transformers and Furious, or whatever you want to call it. Mm-hmm. Like, we're getting. Okay, cool. I'm here for all of it. I am. That would make me a Fast and Furious person.
Yes, and yep. and when it's all said and done, we will also get. Oh man, I totally drew a blank. On Favatar.
Fast Favatar,
the way of the family.
Yeah, yeah. I think we should, I mean, like, integrated into Two Devil, Two Prada, Italian Job, Tokyo Drift. I think we should just add all of it.
Yeah,
they should just put the Fast universe into Fast, should be like.
They should be traveling the multiverse.
It should be.
They should be traveling the multiverse, getting themselves into Fast adventures.
Fast is like, you know, Fast could be like bacon. Like, you can just put it on anything and it tastes good. And that's what they should be doing.
Yeah. So we've solved it. The notorious.
You're welcome, me, studio.
Yeah, me, the notorious hater of the multiverse, have decided that the Fast. Multiverse is what we're all looking for.
I mean,
if there isn't
in the next, you know, whatever, two movies, if they don't either A, go back in time, or B, face a Dom Toretto clone, then I don't know what, like, I think then we failed as a country. I think, like,
well, they've already done the doppelganger bit. They weren't technically from another universe. They were just evil versions of themselves. They've already done that in
six. They did?
Which was my favorite one. Yeah.
Which one is this one?
That was six. That was Fast Six.
I'm going to watch that immediately. I'm immediately going to watch that.
Yeah. So that one's already been done.
Number six.
Yeah.
You even had the character be like, guys, nice. You can guess which character said. He was like, they're like evil versions of us.
Ah, Tyrese. I wish I could remember the Instagram that Tyrese put up, where he was like very wrong about like three things at the same time, and like he quoted, like, it was like a Martin Luther King quote that he attributed to Malcolm X or something. Like, it was something bad. It was something really bad. I can't remember what it was now. And it wasn't like the right quote. I'll find it. It was too good.
But anyways. So yeah, I mean, that one's already been taken. The time travel, listen, I joked, but I think that the way Fast X should end is with them driving into the past. into the beginning of the first movie.
Yeah.
Full circle.
Yep.
But only after we have them in like the zombie apocalypse. You can't just like end it and then not have a zombie apocalypse.
Ooh, the fasting dead.
The fast right, of exactly. us. It's the fast of
the
us.
The fast guys. Of us. Come on. Nice. Nice. Okay, the fast yeah,
that's how, because you know what? That is the only thing that these movies don't have are the double poppies of Oscar Isaac and Pedro Pascal. So you get those guys in there. Forget about it. It's over.
I mean, but we talk about something that Vin can't handle. He can't handle. His family can't handle all those daddies. No. He's like, this is a family with one daddy.
The Fast of Us.
Oh, The Fast of Us. That's the win. That's for the win. We have to move on now. We'll move on to comics. We got some Captain America news. The white one. He's going to get a new run, a new comic run written by J. Michael Straczynski. I'm not sure exactly what the premise of this new run is going to be, but I think he's going to be, doing good things in the country, trying to remind people that America can be great sometimes.
If I'm not mistaken, not only are we getting this new Steve Rogers run, I believe it will be the sole Captain America
book. Oh really? I thought yeah. So there won't be a Sam Wilson?
I don't recall for sure if it was like the actual person who was writing the current one who said it, but it was somebody was like that basically Steve Rogers is going to be the only one with the solo title after like we just had, you know, Ta-Nehisi Coates was writing, you know, and then we had the thing recently with, you know, the current writer had both of them. Like, yeah, no, we're back to a white guy writing Captain America. So,
oh, that's disappointing.
Yeah.
I mean, I honestly thought they were just going to keep going with the two caps, the two Americans.
I mean, I would love to see that because, like, you know, it's timely, but it if I'm not mistaken, rated, you know, it's on Twitter, so you know, take from that what you will, but I believe that it's going to be just Steve, and then, you know, have Sam of course being involved in the Avengers title,
right? But White Cap's going to be part of Uncanny Avengers, so that's why I thought that, you know, I thought that he'd have, they both have.
Uncanny, if I'm not mistaken, is going to only just be like a mini thing, right? I thought it was going to only be like 5 issues.
Oh, I didn't know that. I thought that would.
Again, that's like me trying to like kind of recall off the top of my head. I believe it's only going to be a miniseries.
I think that's right.
Okay. Yeah, I never really know what's a miniseries and what's an ongoing.
Yeah,
because every miniseries is really right. Technically an ongoing, or every ongoing is technically a miniseries.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah, they kind of like label it according to what they sort of think they can get away with. Fine, we'll admit it. This is just a miniseries, but
yeah. So,
but
it's like,
yeah, as best as I recall, Cap, Steve is going to be on Uncanny for just those 5, and then according to however, you know, the sales go, is going to be he has his solo.
Got it. See, obviously, we don't know when the Cap 4 is technically coming out because of, you know, the writer strike. But you got to think that Sam will have a book out before that movie comes out.
I sure hope.
Or something that happens in Avengers. I mean,
right.
Yeah. Or he dies and he comes back with new powers, you know, like that.
Right.
That's what I meant. Go to
the death of Sam Wilson occurs right before Cap 4 comes out.
Look, first of all, I feel like we have I honestly don't know. I'm not sure what else they can add to Sam. He already can talk to birds, right? Unless you're going to actually have him go through like a Joaquin Torres thing where he becomes part bird, I don't really know where you go from there.
No, you see, it's going to be the inverse. he's going to lose the ability to talk to birds.
Ah,
you know, he's going to, you know, in order to match up with, in order to match up with his MCU character.
Right.
He'll have a tech based bird and make us forget about the fact that he could talk to birds.
If Sam Wilson can talk to birds, can he talk? This is such a stupid question. Can he talk to Devil Dinosaur?
I believe the answer is yes. If I'm not mistaken, I think the answer is yes.
He can talk to dinosaurs?
Like through extended effort, I believe so, yes. I don't quote me on it. I want to say it's back in New Avengers or like it was one of those Avengers runs. It's like an event thingamabob, and somebody like suggested that he try to do it, and he's like, oh snap, it worked. And it was like, I think it's something like that. Don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure that's what happened.
That's interesting.
Yeah, you guys have to indulge me just for 1 second, because you know, 90s rapper brain kicked in, and I was like, does Samron also talk to birds? Sorry, never mind. Four people got that reference. He also wears stars and stripes and flags. Dip sets, all right. Anyway, moving on. But that was our news. We're going to come back off of our break, and we're going to hit you with racial draft business, and you guys will forget about the little joke I made. I promise. And we're back. Racial draft business. Might as well start us off with what everyone wants to know: who is in the lead? So we will start us off bottom to top, first place to last place. And because I didn't adequately prep, I'm gonna have to do it live. Oh, wow. With 163 points in last place, the white delegation. Woo! With 187 points. Ninth place, the Swanamena delegation, with 189 points. In eighth place, the Polynesian delegation. So where it gets dicey for our boy, with 223 points. The South Asian delegation in seventh place, with 239 points. The Latinx delegation, what number was that? Was that sixth? With 245 points. The East Southeast Asian delegation,
mm-hmm,
247 points. The multiracial delegation with 285 points. The black delegation.
Mm-hmm.
And that leaves us with our final two delegations at second place with 352 points, the Jewish delegation. And in first place with 368 points, the Native American delegation, as of this very moment.
But I was able to, like, I scrolled up and I in the chat thing, so I was able to follow. I was like, oh, okay, so the order hasn't changed too much from then. It's just the actual specific numbers that have gone up. Okay, cool.
Right. But obviously these things change by the day. So there's a lot of game in front of us. And bringing us on point, we got to talk about the week of picks. What were your impressions of the week overall as we kind of get into it? I'll start with you, Carlos.
Everyone that I wanted is gone. And that sucks. I had a list, man. And I was like, okay, and who do I take that I know? So then I know that I get the other person on the way back. Which one's the strong? Like, I was strategizing. And it all went to shit. And I was left.
Well, we'll get to it.
Scrambling, I say. I was stumped, and no one wants to believe me, but I get stumped at the end of these rounds.
No, I don't believe you.
What were your thoughts, Randy?
Well, I mean, yeah, I feel like I'm sort of excited because everybody's really coming to play this season. But at the same time, the same problem, I'm like, oh yeah, if I choose this one, you know, maybe I can go ahead and get this person now and I'll worry about the other person later. It's like next thing you know, oh yeah, did you want that person? Nice try. I got them. Like and I literally went down the line. I was like, I think it was, yeah, it was like literally two of the people that I listed in tandem. I was like, okay, maybe I can get this person and wait until the next one comes along. And then, you know, because they're not that popular of a character, maybe somebody will overlook them. Nope. In succession, one person got, and then the next one was like, yep, got them too.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's how that went.
Well, I like that because that means that people are, you know, they're not slacking. They're not just reaching for characters because they like the character. They're thinking, no, I mean, I'm gonna try to get this character now because it might not, he or she might not be here for us in the next
Right.
round, you know.
Yeah.
So we'll jump right into it, and we'll, you know, with this character, it kind of hurt. I mean, it, you know, we can talk about it. The white delegation drafted Scott Summers, Cyclops, who, you know, typically, canonically is a white guy. But as I've said in many other occasions, I just think he works better as a person of color. I think his personality is a lot more understandable and a lot more relatable. And he's a lot more likable if he's got this superior, not superiority, sorry, this overachiever complex.
Right,
You know,
right.
because he thinks that he has to be twice as
It's
good.
the respectability politics of it all. Yeah.
Yeah, but if he's just a white guy, he's a dick.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we had in the recent, like I've said it kind of, you know, all over my timeline in this recent Krakoa era. They've characterized him in a way that I kind of enjoy the character more, but. Yeah, I mean, there's no real reason for him to kind of be that uptight and that sort of like self-policing and sort of it doesn't really ring as true because white guys don't really have that sort of social stigma to be like perfect. You know,
Yeah.
they don't really have that on them, and so it just comes across as again, a feeling of like I don't know. It feels like it's sourceless, baseless.
Yeah, because it's like, dude, do you, I mean, yes, as far as mutations go, the fact that you have to wear these like ruby red glasses to
Right.
keep your powers in check, you know, that's a might it's a very minor impediment compared to
Yeah.
some of these other mutations you've got going on. Other than that, you're playing the game on the easy level. And you shouldn't be that repressed
Right.
and worried about screwing up if you've lived in this country for as long as you have. Like, you should
It,
know.
it it's it's very off it's very off-putting to see all this language of like oppression and marginalization and like being seen and treated as the other and wanting to do twice as good to be perceived as half as good and all this stuff like coming from a white guy. It's very weird. It's never not weird. It's always like,
Yeah.
oh, tell me more.
Yeah. Whereas all you got to do is turn that hue up, you know, turn that melanin dial a little bit. And then all of a sudden it's like, look, I may be light skinned, but I'm still a nigger. I mean, I'm
Yeah, you brought
sorry.
out the
Exactly. All of a sudden you're like, you know what? I guess so. I guess so,
I
Drake.
guess so.
I mean, you seem to be living a charmed life, but if you really are worried that in these privileged spaces, you know, you're one mistake away from being, you know, completely niggerized, fine. Okay. I mean,
I just picture Scott
bro.
saying that to Wolverine, and he's just like, you know, you're right. And then they just don't talk about it ever again.
So that's my case for why, even though he was drafted by the white delegation, and I don't disapprove, I don't really approve either, though. You know, it's a tough spot for me. But what do you guys how did you guys feel about the pick?
I think Scott is like, you know, 90s Scott is the whitest white there is. Like he's you know, and that's, you know, when they were positioning him so much against the against Wolverine, he had to be like this uptight, you know, kind of, you know, almost like a like a prep school, basic, that uptight.
Yeah, he's the guy wearing the sweater vest around his neck in the 80s movie.
Right, exactly.
That they turned Scott into Brock, or
they
from...
they turned Scott into like Philip Seymour Hoffman in Scent of a Woman, or whatever.
Or Philip Seymour Hoffman in what's the movie with Matt Damon? Talented in Mr. That... Ripley.
Right, exactly. Whereas actually he's kind of closer to Mr. Ripley, like he's kind of like I have to. I mean, he's not a sociopath, but he
is. He not?
But he has. He, you know, he's there's definitely some like repressed sexual energy going on with Scott, and there's definitely like a I have to be almost something that I'm not in order to get into these rooms and to be, you know, to be equal with these people. Because you do, I mean, if you're an X-Man, you're walking among gods, you know, and yes, you are one of them, but like that one can make floods happen, and like and that one
is he's not the most powerful of them.
right
I mean, that's fair, but I mean we are meant to believe that he is hyper competent, right? We are meant to believe that he's Professor X's you know, star pupil.
Yep,
right.
Yes,
but we always want to kind of dig deep into why it is he wants to do that,
right? And exactly, if he's that's almost like you have I lost my analogy. Anyway, if he ends up
he's Jimmy like, Butler is what no I'm just
no but yeah, again, if he's a white guy, then, you know, he's just not, it doesn't resonate, because he doesn't have to. There is no pressure for him to be the best of the best. He simply doesn't have to. We know this. We know anywhere in society we have these examples of white guys, hate to say it, but, you know, it is what it is, that they're able to kind of give the mediocre bare minimum effort and sort of fail upwards. Like, he's not that. He very much gives his all and tries to put all of his, you know, heart into making sure that he has, you know, we have the iconic panel of like, oh, I'm going to, you know, I'm going to plan two. Don't you mean plan B? It's like, no, that implies I only have 26 plans or whatever. like he's this guy who's like, he's just on it. And right. So it doesn't really ring true, and it lends to a feeling almost like a Mary Sue or whatever, because he has the hot redhead girlfriend, the little tragic history of she dies and all this, like, and then on top of that, he's this smart guy and all, like, I mean, it would be too much, and it kind of does feel too much. A lot of people feel like he's boring or whatever, because he's always sort of in this chosen one sort of these chosen one motifs, has a granddaughter who's supposed to be the savior of mutant kind, and Sinister's always after him for his
and no way and a son who's also supposed to be the savior of mutant kind,
right,
and
exactly.
A supervillain whose entire purpose is to mate him with Jean Grey. He spent like 20 years being like, I really have to hook these people up because they're their child.
And it's like one version of this Nate that we get is supposed to be like this super soldier psychic, you know, powerhouse and stuff, and then we have the other Nate who is Nate Grey, who's like one of the most powerful mutants ever. Like, I mean, come on now. Like, that's a lot.
That's a lot of genetic that's a lot of miscegenation stuff.
Right. That's a lot.
So yeah.
If you put up, you know, turn up the melanin, then Sinister's probably like, that can't be right. Hold on. No, my calculations have to be wrong. Hold on. No.
But they make such pretty babies.
No, you see, that's what I'm saying. That's where Sinister is like, I see it. I mean, you know, they're so cute.
Yeah.
These biracial children. Oh, so yeah, we've said a lot. The listeners, the audience is a little mixed. Right now they are sitting at 82.4% approval rating, with 47.1 strongly approved, 35.3 somewhat approved, 11.8 somewhat disapproved, and 5.9% feeling like I feel, but strongly. You know, I would say it's Madeline Pryor and the children that he abandoned. which is an even more of an argument for turning up the bell.
It was there. I was gonna make the joke, but it wasn't my joke to make.
Now as far as the fan cast, this is not an actor that I am aware of. His name is Kit Connor. He's a little young for an adult Scott Summers. I suppose they're thinking like, you know, teen Scott. Do you guys know this actor?
The name sounds familiar, but the face, I'm blanking.
Yeah.
Looks like he was in Heartstopper.
Oh.
Yeah.
I mean, he looks like exactly the kind of white guy that I do not want Scott Summers to be. You know, white delegation, they had a vision and they wanted to implement that vision. So right now that is a 58.9% approval rating for this fan cast.
Oh, wow. He's very pale. OMG.
Yeah, he's white. He's white Cyclops.
and then in the second picture I'm seeing, he has like the X-Men Evolution hair. So, okay, fine. I guess.
Yeah, but the other thing is that, you know, Scott's nickname is Slim. This guy is kind of like bricked up.
He's Slim Thick.
Yes.
No, but yeah, I mean, like I guess if you want to say like sort of in the way that you can maybe like cast Superman as sort of like any white guy or cast Batman as like any white guy, I guess.
Well, then, but, like I said, then we're really putting him in that category of 90s, 90s Scott.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not feeling it, but
it's well, I guess Wolverine's going to steal your girl, even though it's completely inappropriate. So yeah, like I said, 58.9%, 29.4 somewhat disapproved, and 11.8 strongly disapproved. So very, very strong contingent against against this casting for white Cyclops. For some reason, we'll get to it. Yeah, some reason I, even though they're totally different, Cyborg and Cyclops, it's, you know, you get to that part in the sentence, you're like, Cyclops? That brings us to the next pick, which I have Carlos to thank for helping me see the vision. This is the Polynesian delegation who selected Kurt Wagner, aka Nightcrawler. I like you, was like, how do you make this work?
Yeah.
The listeners can't see when I threw up my hands, but I was wondering how we can have a Polynesian Nightcrawler. And I didn't think about the fact that, sadly, colonizers is going to colonize. And right. Apparently there are German people who adopt Polynesian children. And you could totally imagine a story where these parents adopt themselves a Polynesian baby. You know, they do that. What's that movie with Elliot Page?
Juno.
Yes. Ah. You know, so like where they, you know, adopt a child before they're born. And then they get the child and then there's buyer's remorse. They're like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or even I was thinking like if he again like was born looking like a regular Polynesian human child, and then surprise, surprise, around, you know, adolescence or whatever, they like, oh, so I guess the Catholicism lessons aren't taking. You're turning into a demon. That's
but I do think something about that. I mean, I haven't paid close attention to the retcons, but I thought he was one. I thought that was one of his stories. One of the aspects his story is that then the Catholics went hard on him because either his parents abandoned him or they tried to be like extra Catholic to excise the demon.
Best as I recall, the actual canon story is that he was born looking like that, and then he was abandoned. First by Mystique, and then, you know, he like ended up in like the circus and all this other stuff. So but that's the only reason why I say it like that is because you would want him to basically have time to sort of like learn from them, I guess, learn the language and learn the you know, the teachings of the Catholic Church and all that stuff. And I feel like that would have been like they're sort of the resentment already of being Polynesian and having your, you know, being treated as if anytime you speak your language, it's bad. Mm-hmm. Anytime you blah, 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 blah. And then all of a sudden now we have the shocking horror of like, oh no.
Right. Well, that's why what I was imagining was a scenario where the parents are like well-meaning liberal Germans. You know, and you know, they're like, oh yeah, we're totally going to, you know, connect him with his culture. Like, we're not just going to be your standard, you know, white parents who are raising and you know, a Polynesian child. And then they're like, oh hell no. It's like all of that goes out the window, and then they go heaven, and you know, and they try it out, right? So they go to church, they become like really religious, they try to pray out the mutation, and then eventually a few years go by, because in terms of the teleportation, is that aspect always present? Because you could imagine a scenario where he has the look that he has, but he doesn't develop the teleportation until a little older. Mm-hmm. You know, and then that's when they're like, oh no, no, it's hard enough raising a demon
Brimstone
baby. but now I got a child that anytime I try to beat him, he just disappears.
He disappears to limbo, right? Isn't that where he goes?
yes he does.
Yeah,
you know, so like
he disappears to a godless place.
Yeah, I think it could work for sure. You know, and I think it can fit in the canon. Obviously, we've said before that I'm not a huge fan of KJ Apa as an actor, but you know, maybe you spend spoiler alert for the fan cast that we didn't get to yet. But yeah, I mean, you know, you put him in the lab with a whole bunch of German vocal coaches, and yeah, he's a Samoan German. Who looks demonic. Uh-huh. I can live with it. It wouldn't have been what I initially thought, but I, you know, wrapping my mind around the adoption angle, I think it could totally work, and I think it'd be really cool. What do you guys think in that respect?
Yeah, no, I think you know, I asked the question because I was interested to see if Tomati saw Nightcrawler as being necessarily Catholic. Which I felt like when I think of Nightcrawler's characterization, it's the first thing that comes to mind, even though I know that that's not something that's always been there. Mm-hmm. That was more of a focus in the, what is it, the 80s, I guess.
Yeah, where they but that's, I mean, that's the it. Period where he became his most popular.
Right. So I just wanted to see, you know, I was fully ready for Tom to be like, not necessarily, but... It ended up actually, no, it's super informed by, of course, trauma.
Right.
Which, you know, wow, that's shocking that trauma would inform an X-Men character.
Exactly. Trauma and religious, what's the word? Orthodoxy. So.
Yes, right.
So yeah, I'm all about it. Currently though, it's got an uphill climb with a little bit under a day left for the polling. 71.4% approval rating right now. With 50% strongly approve, 21.4 somewhat approve, and 28.6 somewhat disapprove. So I would imagine that if there was an opportunity for people to hear the backstory, that approval would go higher, because sure. You know, my initial reaction was confusion. So yeah. I could see that being for others. In terms of the fan cast, we said this before, KJ Apa, if I had more faith in him as an actor, I might be in more of the camp of the strongly approve, but I'm kind of feeling like I'll give him the benefit of the doubt in this one case. But as far as other people though, they're not doing that shit. It is 50-50, 50% strongly approve, 50% approval with 35.7 strongly approve and 14.3 somewhat approve and 35.7 somewhat disapprove and 14.3 strongly disapprove. So results are, as they say, mixed. Speaking of, damn, that's not a good transition because that's not where we're going. Not mixed. The South Asian delegation, and this pick of Loki Laufey-sun. What did you guys think when you saw this pick? I'll start with you, Carlos.
It's a pick that I thought I was going to be able to get a little bit later. Mm-hmm. It's a sneaky good pick because Loki shows up a lot. He's actually it's kind of shocking how much Loki shows up.
Not to mention that he has a show that's coming out in the fall.
Yes,
he's got correct. A book that's launching, I believe, this month.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
So, whatever level he shows up, we can expect even more exposure from Loki.
Right.
I mean, I do think it's always a little tricky to make it work with the kind of Norse mythology of it all. I think that. Ideally, if you wanted to make it work, it would be, you know, playing up the whole like frost giant thing and all, you know, the fact that he's adopted clearly, but also perhaps if, you know, given that he's a god of mischief, maybe there's some overlap between gods of mischief in other religious, it's not religious, mythological traditions.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, he's not only Loki from the Norse mythology, but he's ex-trickster god from another mythology, you know?
Right.
But we haven't really gotten anything in that respect. But I'm hoping we still have time for the South Asian delegation to get in there and talk it up and you know, tighten up the story a little bit and give it the storyline basis and buttressness, you know, buttress that claim as far as I'm concerned. What did you think, Randy?
I think I actually might have like missed, like I might have been like busy or something when that one was announced, because I totally missed it. But what I will say is, yeah, I mean, there's various tricksters in mythology, and so it's not too difficult to say that, as you said, like as if he had posed as different tricksters in the history, and I do feel like there, I mean, I don't know, it's you know, there the Norse mythology part of it is inevitable, like in terms of trying to make sure that you don't break the character, so that absolutely does require an actual story to kind of explain it. Otherwise, you can just have the white delegation be like, nope, challenge.
Yeah, I mean, it helps that he is it does help that he's a shapeshifter, right? Yes. So like, yeah, he could easily just be like, yeah, I mean I'm hanging out with white people, so I gotta play the part, like,
right? Yeah.
That's me being low key.
So
yeah, I'm surprised the whites didn't challenge my pick of Thor. So,
well, you know, they're loath to do the I feel like the hardest challenge to win, honestly, is a white delegation challenge.
Yeah, but if there's gonna be one character, it'd be a Norse god.
Fair, good point. Fair yeah. point. But I'm just, you know,
if it were me,
we don't want to be making that case.
No, it's too late now. It's been rounds.
Exactly. So
if they want to switch first picks with me, that's fine. I'll take Nightwing.
Right. But yeah, so 87.5% approval rating for South Asian Loki, which is much higher than I thought it would be at. I've got to be being honest. 66.7 strongly approve, 20.8 somewhat approve, 8.3 somewhat disapprove, and 4.2% racist.
And have they given a
fan cast?
Yeah, have they given?
Yes, they did. Their fan cast was Riz Ahmed. And
that might explain a couple of things in terms of approval ratings.
Yes. So as of now, their approval rating is sitting at 89.5% approval. 73.7 strongly approve, 15.8 somewhat approve, and 10.5 somewhat disapprove. So one vote away.
If Riz Ahmed asked me to kneel, then say no more. Like, I don't know what else to tell you. Like, yes, absolutely. Anything else?
All right, fair. I mean, listen, you heard it here first. You heard it here first. Blow key.
I think that was pretty high key. I'm not gonna lie.
That brings us to a defensive pick.
You hear that?
Yeah, but I only hear it when you talk. Actually, that's not true.
I hear it when you talk.
Yeah, it seems like an echo. Hold on a second, listeners. This brings us back. We're technical difficulties averted. We were talking about the Swana Mena delegation and their defensive pick, which is the hierarchy changer himself, Black Adam, Teth Adam. And I think, you know, obviously in earlier seasons, one might expect him to go a little earlier in the draft, but I think this is a good place for him, honestly. He is one of probably the highest profile character of Swana background in DC. You know, I mean, at least as far as like full, you know, because there's Damian Wayne, who's, you know, traditionally partially, and that's not always been at the forefront of his character. But as far as, you know, Black Adam, it's, you know, it's either ancient Egypt or a fictionalized version of ancient Egypt.
Right.
You know, and I think that if we really wanted to get into like the things that I like about his story, the distrust of Western powers, like, you know, him not seeing himself as a villain just because all these other superheroes from the Western world don't appreciate the things that he does to make his people feel safe against people who wanted to exploit his homeland. You know, I think that that's a aspect of his story that kind of needs him to remain, you know, Southwest Asian. So,
yeah,
or North African, as it were. So yeah, I mean, I love it. I think it's a solid pick. You know, it's going to be hard to say for sure that with no movie on the horizon and with the whole rock of it all, whether we will see more Black Adam. You know, we definitely won't see as much Black Adam this season as we saw last season. In other forms of media, just remains to be seen whether in comics he'll still continue to be one of the high profile characters. What do you think, Randy? of Black Adam?
I think, unfortunately, we're not guaranteed to see Black Adam in Shazam or in JSA, even though those are the titles that are most typically associated with him whenever he's not in his own solo thing. Like, and on top of that, Black Adam comic is coming to a close. I think there's like one more issue to come out. So, I mean, yeah.
Yeah. No, I agree. You know, I think it's one of those where, you know, you got to cross your fingers that the push isn't over. you know, he's got a sustained push over the last couple of years.
It absolutely feels like we are at the hind end of his push.
Yeah. I mean, he was in Justice League last year. He was, he still got that. What's that event called that DC is doing?
Night Terrors.
You know, I mean, he's got something related to that. I think it would be a bad look. I mean, if we're being honest, I think it would be a bad look to take their sort of one. Well, no, I guess he's not the only one, but he's the one Justice League level character from that part of the world that has really ascended to the top tier.
I mean, then, but they don't even entirely know what they want to do. They don't really know what they want to do with Shazam. Like, it's they're in a very weird space right now in terms of what they want to do with those characters. And so,
right, like, but I feel like the difference between him and Shazam is that, like, it's almost borderline malpractice that they haven't figured out how to make Shazam work. But that's been a recurring theme that they just kind of keep screwing up Shazam. Whereas with Black Adam, it felt like they've been successful at elevating him. Why would they want to abandon that, you know, even though the movie didn't do all that it was supposed to do?
I mean, because I feel like the movie would have been sort of the bigger proof of concept. Right. Because like that's like Miles Morales. We got Miles Morales. It was a cool character that we like. But when he first started, he was very controversial because, OK, we got rid of Peter Parker. We blah, 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 blah. And then on top of that, the story, a lot of people, you know, folks who don't necessarily pay attention, but that's neither here nor there. But they were trying to say like, oh, he's just a black Peter. And he's blah, 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 blah. But then we actually see games and movies and shows and stuff that comes out, and it's like, you know, they're winning over the audience because, as we all know, the sort of more easily accessible medium for the characters is movies, TV, and games. Those three. If you fail there, then it doesn't really matter what you do in the comics so much, because those three are far more accessible, more likely for somebody to seek them out. And comics have a very long history of being intimidating in terms of like, where the heck do I start in terms of reading this character? But a game, jump straight in.
No, you're right. That is true. And, you know, presumably without The Rock as a strong advocate for the character in those larger, bigger media, you know, that you could find that character falling by the wayside. I would hope not, which is kind of why you would hope that someone, you know, we can get into the fan cast now, you know, someone that's actually of Swanamena background, Egyptian actor, kind of portraying the role and advocating for the character specifically as a North African superhero, would be a way of buoying that, because you don't necessarily want to, just because he's not The Rock, you know, doesn't mean that he's not important for representation.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, but hey, maybe he'll die and come back and
and he'll come back conspicuously resembling The Rock.
No, he'll come back looking like a totally different dude, since he doesn't have to look like The Rock. You know, so anyway, from an approval perspective, he is at 77.8 approval, with all 77.8 strongly approve, and 11.8 somewhat disapprove, and 11.8 racist. With the fan cast, are you familiar with this actor, Zico Zaki?
No.
Yeah, apparently he plays police. he plays on the FBI show. He's got some storylines where he's deals with the struggle of being Middle Eastern in the FBI. And he's talked a lot about how he's, because he's Egyptian American, having that identity, obviously that wouldn't be a part of Black Adam's identity, but just, as an American actor of Egyptian descent, trying to sort of represent for his people.
Yeah.
70% approval for this casting. 60% strongly approve, 10% somewhat approve, 20% somewhat disapprove, and 10% Islamophobia. that brings us.
Is it really Islamophobia if the character isn't, is adhering to Greek gods?
Well, technically, I think it's ancient Egyptian gods, but
The Shazam stands for different.
Yeah, it stands for different. Gotta love acronyms.
Yeah.
and recently, Mary Marvel, she got her own.
She got her own acronym.
Yep, she got her own acronym. With
did she? Wait for it. Shazam.
it's nothing but goddesses.
Yep. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Shazam.
it was I think I forget who all it was, but it was like, I was like, oh, okay, that's kind of clever. They, not bad.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, if that's the energy that they want to put into Shazam, then that opens things up for this character. He has not yet been drafted this season. So if you want to get those extra points, maybe you can decide on an acronym. or a blackronym. Or a blackronym.
Cause see now I'm feeling kind of salty. I feel like, okay, well, where's Darla's African deity acronym? Like, what's going on? You're gonna just like give them all the Greek stuff, and then, oh yeah, Darla, we're not gonna consider her now. That's fine.
Do they all still say Shazam, or do they say different words now?
They all say
Shazam, but the thing is, I think the only two who currently wield the power in the family is just Billy and Mary.
Right.
I think that might be what it is. I don't recall, like, because I haven't read it in a while, but I think it's just those two currently.
Well, yeah. And Black Adam too,
Mm-hmm.
He's not part of,
well, but that's what I'm saying. Like, Black Adam and his descendant Bolt, those two, they wield the power. But
Bolt?
Malik, yeah. But then the Shazamily, the actual like Billy and his siblings, I think it's just him and Mary right now.
So I haven't finished that run. I got a lot halfway through it. They're sharing that power, right?
They're sharing like the name that they call, but it's different deities. So
it is I'm saying Black Adam and Bolt.
I honestly don't know. I haven't read Black Adam yet.
Oh, okay, because where I was,
I kind of had like some interweaving reading between Lazarus Planet and then the first issue of this current Shazam run.
Okay, where I was in the run, he's mm-hmm. sort of an ancient, not ancient, but he's a descendant, mm-hmm. a far flung descendant, the last descendant. Of Teth Adam,
mm-hmm.
so that explains somewhat his connection. Right. And I thought my understanding is that he's transferred his Shazam power to his long multi-century descendant.
I have no idea. I haven't read Black Adam. I need to, okay. But. Yeah,
I mean, it was good what I was reading, because it's Christopher Priest, and mm-hmm. Christopher Priest loves an unlikable protagonist. So, he also struggles with, like, we got to come up with a term for when black people in their like late 40s try to write black people in their teens and 20s, because it's it can get rough out there. Get rough.
You're saying we need to come up with a phrase like the same, like fridging. We need to come up with something like that
nigging.
I'm not doing that. I'm sorry.
Yeah. We can call it for now, until we come up with a better term, we'll just call it exaggerated swagger.
Right.
Exaggerated swaggering. Or Rodney Barnesing.
Right, exactly.
Yeah, Falcon is for now.
Is that what happened? is that what happened with
That's not what happened with Miles Morales' story.
Is that what happened with Miles Morales? Man, Randy, you're in my head today.
Yeah, no, but here's the thing: was that from that run, the exaggerated swagger of a black teen? Because I thought that was from a different.
I believe that's older. I think, matter of fact, I think that may have been actually an article that was put out. Somebody wrote it, and it was like, "What in the world are you talking about?" But but then somebody we just kind of started using it because that's crazy. Not the exaggerated swagger, but the phrasing of it is funny.
Right. Yeah. The one that always comes to mind for me is the Falcon run with our guy Patriot. But there have been a number of occasions. And again, you don't want them to write black characters with no swagger at all.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, you don't want them to stop trying, but you just don't want it to be over the top.
You want it to feel authentic, not like they're just doing like Mad Libs Urban Dictionary edition. Like, it's, you know, just throw on period on my mama. Like, no, shut up. Yeah. We don't talk like that.
Now, one thing I will say, sorry if I came in too loud, listeners. One thing I will say is that I think that, you know, we're a little bit spoiled because we just saw Spider-Verse. And we know that, like, in actual performance of these characters, like, it gives them more authenticity and more lived-in depth. And like reading words on a page, they're always going to seem a lot more stilted, and they're always going to seem a lot more like wrong.
Well, but it's always, to me, every time, it's always a matter of the exact word choice or like where it's placed,
mm-hmm.
I guess, and also who they're talking to. Like, we already know the phrase code switching. Like, you talk a certain way with your peers, with your friends, or whoever. You don't talk the same way around everybody necessarily. Right. So,
no, I get that part. But what I'm saying is that, like, for instance, like, if you compare like Twitter to TikTok, mm-hmm. right? Like, a 13-year-old, we'll say, or 16-year-old on TikTok, like, we're getting their clip. We're getting them like how they actually are, like how they actually speak. But if you try to take what was said on TikTok and translate it to Twitter, it could look crazy.
Well, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, it has to be. I don't know. It's because we do have the understanding that some people speak slang, blah blah. That's why we have like accent writers. That's why we got like we know that if you have Cannonball, or if you have Rogue, or if you have Gambit, they're gonna have a certain kind of I said and blah blah blah, and they try to make it like a country accent. Like, you try to spell the country accent how it's, you know, phonetically it's gonna sound, and that, you know, we know that. But I think that there's a line to be drawn between sort of generally speaking slang, and then specifically kind of speaking of like certain words and phrases that just recently became popular, and I think that's what sort of rubs folks the wrong way.
Yeah, no, I agree with that. I mean, I want to be fair to these writers that like that. That's hard. It's really hard to capture the cadence and the spirit of young people when you're like several decades older than them.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
You know, and then to put it on the printed page, it take 2 months, 2 to 3 months to actually your script to come out. Like, you know, and
yeah,
like it everything moves so fast. Like I try not to go be as hard on them, but there are times where I'm like, you're out of touch.
It's certain, like it definitely feels like it hits more with certain people just because they I guess trying to think what's the difference, because obviously like you said, Rodney Barnes, and then but like if you sort of see the way that Vita Ayala phrases stuff, they're very good at sort of making it feel conversational as opposed mm-hmm. to like things that you would have to read from a script. Like it feels
Vita's in their 20s, right?
I think they're like about with me. Like I'm 31, so about in that age range.
Okay.
So like I'm you know, I'm no spring chicken. But I feel like that's, you know, just sort of having the like, I don't know, you kind of can tell who is sort of shut off from that sort of mm-hmm. speaking, who doesn't really actually talk like that. And now they have to sort of make an effort to get themselves in the mindset. Oh, what do those youths say? What do those yeah. young whippersnappers say? And then, you know, it sounds very stilted and just inauthentic.
You know what?
Yeah.
Vita is actually with me. Vita is 38.
Wow. Okay,
see, exactly.
Did not know that. Wow. I wouldn't have expected that at all.
Vita's Vita's got a black very young crack. Face.
That, yeah. Exactly. There we go. Right.
Yeah.
But we should get into it on a future episode, but like we should try to figure out whether there's a like room for a like youth authenticity coordinator position.
look
like okay, someone who could
for anybody who has not read it, if I don't care if that's your first introduction to the characters, if you have not read it, go read it right now. Vita Ayala's run on New Mutants.
Mm-hmm.
Go read it. It's so freaking good. I'm like, can you please bring them back over to the DC side and let them write for the Teen Titans? Pretty pleased with all the cherries, because it's so good in terms of like not just, I guess, the dialogue and you know, the specific stories of the adventures and stuff, but when you get the sort of introspection and them each talking about like their feelings about these different things that happens and all the sort of like what they're going through, it is so well articulated and it feels very human. It feels very much like a person is speaking their mind, as opposed to just like you can tell where the effort is a little bit more fluid and where it's a little bit more stilted with writers.
Yeah, this is where my Marvel bias comes through, because I'm like, no, we got to get Vita on Champions.
Well, I mean, he was really good with Champions too.
Who was?
No, I was just about to say, Ewing did well with Champions. Yes. With Ironheart did really well. Mm-hmm. You know, did really well in terms of writing for She was the one who wrote with Monica Rambeau, correct?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. So I'm like, yeah, that's a really great voice there that you hear. And it's like, I don't know, you get certain people who are really like just sort of in touch with that, as opposed to someone who is trying to sort of recall it as something unfamiliar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, you're right.
Eve Ewing and I both come from the same neighborhood in Chicago, and I have never met her, and that sucks.
Well, you got to make that happen.
She's so close to my.
Is she still on social media?
I'm not sure, actually.
I mean, she's probably wisely sort of not having too much affiliation.
No, because yeah, you should like, try to, I mean, not to give you professional advice live on the podcast, but, you know, you should try to see if you could set something up in advance of her Black Panther run for Agents of Fandom.
I was hoping that she was going to be at C2E2 and, like, I would have that. Hey, we're from the same neighborhood, but according to Wikipedia, we're from the same neighborhood. But, yeah, she grew up in the same neighborhood, and it wasn't like... Chicago's a small town. I know it's a big city, but it's a small town. Like, you kind of know everybody. It's kind of wild.
I don't think that there's been a whole lot of interviews with her, actually.
That's interesting.
Like, I think, yeah, you probably, like, she probably, like, sort of chomping at the bit to kind of, like, put it out there. So,
yeah. So, anyways, that I digress. Yeah. I was just
hey, listen. I mean, you know, if you'd like to do the interview not for Agents of Fandom but for the Racial Draft podcast, that's fine too. But you know, I'm you know, we'll talk about it offline. But let's continue on to this pick, which, you know, I've gone back and forth about this character. So let's get into it. This is Oliver Queen, the Green Arrow. By the East Southeast Asian delegation. I think that there are strong arguments for Oliver Queen as a white man.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. But I do think that if we're going to pick a non-white group for Oliver Queen to be,
I would have had a much harder time selling it. We'll put it that way.
Yeah. Like, I think that there's, you know, the combination of him being kind of West Coast based, you know, so those cities, you know, on the Pacific coast, like, sure. there is a tradition of, you know, prominent Asian families who would have emigrated to the States and establish them, you know, their families and their companies, and him growing up as a child of privilege in that part of the world. Like, it's not that far out of the realm of possibility of there being a sort of like worldly playboy, you know, version of Oliver Queen that's not a white guy. And still kind of have that same level of, like, needs to be taken down a notch. You know, he thinks that he's liberal, but he's really not as liberal as he thinks he is. I think it can work as an East Asian, but obviously, in terms of really kind of needling the character and his foibles, he's also fun as a white guy. What do you think about that, Carlos?
I kind of see Ollie as, there are similarities between Ollie and Danny Rand.
Sure.
And you know, kind of playboy white guy, you know, like, it's just kind of like, I see.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, you know, bow and arrow. Okay. I can see like a few different.
Yeah, but that's the thing about archery, right? Like, so archery, like, there's the Robin Hood view of archery, but then there's also archery having a very long tradition in Asia and, you know, and Asian Americans being excelling in archery, you know.
That's exactly what I'm saying. It's like, you know, samurai used to use bow and arrow in their you know, when they fought. It wasn't just swords. And
I mean, he's got a whole lot of Asian influence around him, like Lady Shiva, Cheshire, sister Emiko Queen, Black Canary was trained up with Lady Shiva, and he has this love shadow.
There's a whole slew of Asian of Asian love interests and Asian allies hanging around the Green Arrow mythos. Like, yeah.
I can see it, even though the archetype does lend itself very much to being like a white guy. I can see I can see an East Asian Ali Queen.
Yeah. Oliver Kwan. Yeah. Like, well, in my head canon, it's like the Kwan family came to the States and they were like, all right, we're gonna like just tweak our name just a little bit.
Yeah, right.
Queen, from Kwan to Queen, and Americans will be none the wiser. The company is Queen, but the original family is Kwan. And you know, then they're off to the races in racist America.
I used to work with a guy who's his last name was Law. He was Chinese American. I was like, so your family's name was Lau, right? And he's like, yes, that's exactly what it was.
Exactly.
And we changed it to Law. Yeah.
Right. And then off to the races in racist America. Mm-hmm. So it's like Queen consolidated. It's like Kwan consolidated was right there, but we were like, let's not. So I go back and forth. Because I'm here for the diversity and I'm here for the race bending, like I'm here for the pick. I can't really disapprove of it, but I can definitely understand why it may not be the first choice for a delegation for this character, because of the way that him being this, like that classic quote unquote social justice warrior, you know, that person that's like really, really trying hard to be liberal, but like it's doing too much. Yeah. Like, but I'm here for it. What about you, Randy?
I mean, it works for me. Like I said, if there's any, I mean, well, you said it, but basically if there's any other ethnicity, I mean, that's really the closest that you can sort of imagine. I guess the easiest that you could imagine, it wouldn't be too difficult to sort of like, you know, connect those dots.
Well, yeah, except for the skeleton key demographic, which is, of course, the multiracial delegation. Like,
yeah, exactly.
Yeah. they can make everything work.
Yeah.
But so yeah, from the approval standpoint, currently 86.6. Wait, yes, 86.6. percent approval, with 53.3 strongly approve, 33.3 somewhat approve, 6.7 somewhat disapprove, and 6.3% racist. Huh. As far as the fan cast, I'm gonna give a little bit of credit because I was in conversation with the delegation about possible choices, and I thought this was a good one. Daniel Henney, the mm-hmm. Korean American model slash actor slash pretty attractive man.
You don't say. The model was.
Yeah, exactly. And he has. Listen, you don't often see. You don't often see someone with an Oliver Queen goatee being able to make it work. So good on him. Good on him. So. He was the fan cast, and he is currently sitting at 84.6% approval, 69.2% strongly approve, and 15.4% somewhat approve, with 15.4% somewhat disapprove. So, you know, if you want to try to get him up to 90%, go ahead and cast that vote, listeners. But I could see it. This would not be the first season that Green Arrow has been drafted by the East Southeast Asian delegation. So I don't have a problem with it. That brings us to another repeat player, and that is the multiracial delegation and Moon Knight.
Yep.
Moon Knight, Latino and Jewish. As it was.
so technically Carlos got it.
as it was intended by the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It's a twofer with Mark Spector as portrayed by Oscar Isaac. Ever heard of him? Look,
yeah,
look, Oscar Isaac has played Israelis in the movies before. He's apparently he's doing that thing that we did the couple weeks ago where we were like, yeah, they're Latinos in the movies.
Uh-huh.
So
Oscar Isaac is Jewish, like Giancarlo Esposito is
anything, South American.
Anything from South America. Yeah.
Exactly. He's the inverse of Giancarlo
Esposito. I think that Latino actors claiming Judaism in their lineage is like, it's the equivalent of like Black people saying, I got Cherokee in my blood. It's like, I'm sorry, you're pretty sure that your great great grandfather was half Jewish? Fuck out of here. You don't know shit. You don't want to get called out for playing a Jew. That's it.
Or he's just like, I don't want to play a drug dealer anymore. I'm tired of playing drug dealers. Yeah. Can I play something else?
Yeah.
He's like, I would not have gotten that inside Llewellyn Davis role.
Yeah, exactly.
My last name was Hernandez. So
I mean, I to this day believe that Marvel didn't know he was Latino when they cast him for Moon Knight.
No, they looked at his body of work and they were like, clearly.
They said, Coen brothers, sign him up.
So, yes, we don't have to say that much more than what we've already said. Approval rating for this version of Moon Knight. 86.7%. 66.7% strongly approved, 20% somewhat approved, 6.7% somewhat disapproved, and 6.7%. Are you really Jewish? And they have the Oscar Isaac fan cast, 84.6%. Again, people who were like, you fool me once.
Right.
So 80.8 strongly approve, 3.8 somewhat approve, 3.8 somewhat disapprove, and like I said, 11.5 not a real Jew.
I mean, listen, I don't care how many frontiers you have to look at, triple frontiers, quadruple frontiers, you're not finding a Jewish frontier in Oscar Isaac's lineage.
But look, all that being said, I don't have a dog in the fight, but I'm perfectly fine with the introduction of Latino heritage into Mark Spector's background, as long as we don't lose the Jewish aspect of his character.
I mean,
I do think it's something that, go ahead, Randy.
No, I just was about to say it's really timely that, you know, we got the Jed McKay Moon Knight run, because I mean, if you look at the portrayals of him in that specific comic, he has definitely had his complexion darkened. Like, because I mean, you know, they're over in the mutant comics, they're not doing great with Sunspot, but in Moon Knight, they're like, yep, he's got some brown. It's absolutely, it's brown.
All right.
And I was going to say that I think it's culturally abhorrent that in the MCU, the most brutal personality is the one who only speaks Spanish. Fuck out of here, Kevin Feige. I'm on.
That is a very, I mean, his name is Jake Lockley.
Yeah, Jake
Lockley. Not really sure where that came from.
Right.
Because I feel like it would have been even more funny if he was like, no, I don't know. He's just the white part of me. Like, where that personality came from. Speak perfect English. No accent whatsoever. Yeah, the origin story for Jake Lockley is going to be a little hard to figure out. The fact that he doesn't speak any English.
Right.
Yes. Like Jake Lockley.
He also needs to have like another one that they just create for the show that is like just a Woody Allen impression. It's like, oh, you're Jewish? Let's hear it. Let's see. That's what you got.
Oh man, that would be amazing.
And now that I think about it, now that you bring it up, like Jake Lockley not only speaks Spanish, but like he's kind of got like a wild eye. Like he kind of looks at you like he's kind of like he's sort of like a little bit unhinged.
I mean, and not only does he have a wild eye, the reason you know that is because he's not wearing a mask.
Right.
So they made him the stupid one too? He's just going to commit these crimes without a mask on?
They made him the one that's like, yeah, you're going to see my face. My conspicuously brown face.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Like, the name Jake Lockley. Like, it's just going to confuse
you. Who's posing as the chauffeur?
Right. And as he's like beating a dude to a, you know, to a pulp, he's like, and what are you going to tell them? That I saw a Jewish man. That's exactly right. Or Jake Lockley will revisit you.
A Jewish man with a Cockney accent. That's right.
Oh, okay. Man.
All right, fair enough. The Moon Knight mythos could use some cleaning up. We'll figure that out. But one thing I will say, people love their fan art.
Yeah.
they listen. Whew, more fan art than you can shake a stick at.
Then you can shoot a bullet at.
I don't know. I think plenty of people have shaken their sticks at the fan art of
Oscar Isaac. Isaac is a stick shaker for sure.
Yeah, right.
No comments.
The stick shaker.
Oh man, yeah, that's the cheat code that draft someone who's played by Oscar Isaac. That brings us to the Native American delegation and another character that has been a mainstay in the racial draft for the Native American delegation, going all the way back to the first season of the racial draft, and that is Johnny Blaze, the Ghost Rider. I don't know, I mean, there's so many cool reimaginings that we've dealt with over the years. Like, I don't think that much needs to be said about the idea of, you know, of the spirits kind of finding their putting their hooks into Jonathan Blaze, the Native American stunt driver. Mm-hmm. I think it works. I think it's sort of a natural working. I think it even works extra well, given that there's like Kushala, the spirit rider, mm-hmm. you know, from kind of a century before. You could sort of tie in the lineage of the spirit of vengeance being kind of, I mean, hell, you could even say it's like something that even more drawn to Native American people because they have something to be vengeance, something to right. seek vengeance.
So much history of injustice,
innocent blood. Yeah, innocent blood being spilled. You know, like so. I mean, I do hope that Toriano, when he finally submits to me, like his 47-page backstory for
so Native American. You're saying is next season I should go for Johnny Blaze. I see.
Yeah, I mean. I'm surprised. Has there never been a Black Ghost Rider?
I don't think so.
Interesting. Yeah, that is weird.
The term Ghost Rider is too evocative of the Klan. You can't have one.
I mean, it's also evocative of like Ghostface Killer. Like, I mean, it's not too far off.
I mean, that's gotta be the direction that you go.
Ghostface Rider. Ghostface
Rider. Ghostface Killer sounds like Ghost Rider's like nemesis. like actually, that's kind of dope. Like a spirit of like whatever that is just against the spirit of vengeance, and like a long line of like anti-Ghost Riders who are just black. Black throughout history.
I don't know. I feel like that's like giving Turn the Other Cheek Martin Luther King, though. the spirit of forgiveness.
Yeah, no, it can't be forgiveness. There's a spirit of vengeance and the spirit of I don't know what. But But just like having like the same way like Spawn, like there are spawns and there are the same way there are like spawns and redeemers, like you just get like Ghost Riders and whatever Ghostface Killers. And then ironically, like Old Dirty Bastard was a Ghostface Killer. But he told that to Ghostface, and Ghostface is like, I'm taking that name. I'm sorry. You're just gonna have to be some old dirty bastard.
Yeah, not to be confused with the white version of the spirit. It's the ghost strongly worded letter writer.
Yes.
Right. The ghost hood killer.
Yeah. But I mean, I gotta strongly approve of Native American Ghost Rider. So as of now, 76.5% approval rating for Native American Ghost Rider, which is much lower than I would have expected, honestly. 70.6 strongly approve, 5.9 somewhat approve, 5.9 somewhat disapprove, and 17.6% racist.
Wow.
I gotta err on the disapproving side. I feel like Toriano's gotten enough points thus far.
Oh, that is the ghost spiter.
I was gonna say the spirit of spite, but I didn't want to. But I think it's just shown its face. That's it. It's ghost face.
Yeah. That is the petty and stare. Oh no. All right. Mystery solved. speaking of the black delegation, let's talk about it. Sam Wilson. Yes. Captain America. Black Captain America.
Yep.
Two Americas.
Right on time for his solo to end. Like a couple of days later, like, yep, actually we're done with that. That's
we've told enough of your black ass story. Sam Wilson, what Layson, everything about this man and his story is black, you know, trying to do good in his community, supporting the white hero despite not having as many powers as the white hero, doing good, finally like earning the respect. And as soon as he gets the colors, they're like, nope, not my Captain America.
and literally has to work like several times as hard to get half as far because he does not have the freaking super soldier serum.
Not to mention the fact that America was like, we would rather have a fascist. we would rather have a fascist as our captain. Yeah. So yeah. You know, you gotta get the hell out of here with that. Yep. So yeah, I mean, I can't do anything but strongly approve of Black Captain America, Sam Wilson. And right now, 89.5% approval rating for Black Sam Wilson. So one vote away from that threshold. Now, as far as the fan cast, looks, you know, Anthony Mackie is a controversial figure. He has not always inspired confidence, even among...
I was trying my best not to be petty and like also take Laz Alonso for like it was either him or Laz Alonso. I was like, okay, fine. Let me not.
No, I see. I would have gone with. I would have gone with John David Washington myself. I would have just slid right in there. nobody dislikes John David Washington.
I would have gone with Aldous Hodge. That would have been mine.
No, you see, the problem with Aldous Hodge though is that you wouldn't have been able to buy all those years that he was just like hanging out as Steve's buddy, like not like, you know, like not secretly like the better of the two.
Yeah, it's fair.
But and plus, you know, listen, we know that part of what comes with being cast as Captain America is like kind of being squeaky clean. Like outside of like in real life, and you know every day I worry that we're gonna get some Anthony Mackie story or interview that's gonna be like, fuck.
When is the final issue of Symbol of Truth?
It's coming up soon, I think. Like, it's definitely not gonna last us throughout the whole draft.
Well, the event's going through the summer, right?
I think so. Mm-hmm. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure, but I yeah, you're right. Yeah. So Cold War is gonna be like it's gonna be here for a little while.
So probably like September.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's fair. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, again, there's more than enough time for them to announce another thing. Plus the fact that, like, you know, he's shown up in, like, animated form. You know, he's shown up in Moon Girl, you know, technically not in part of our season. But, you know, I don't think that Marvel's going to have him kind of go away. Like, you know.
Oh, I definitely don't think he's going to go away. It's just that, like, when I heard that he was supposedly that Steve was going to be the only one with the solo, I'm like, okay, well, he's going to be like the background kind of support character in Avengers. I mean, obviously not a background character, but, you know, a solo allows a lot more elaboration on one specific person as opposed to kind of being part of the group, you know, ensemble.
No, I definitely agree with that. But I also think that, you know, this is probably a good time to talk about this. So remember that controversy a few months back when it was the cover that had like Sam Wilson and T'Challa fighting, and right. You know, some of the people in our circle like had an issue with that. You know, based on this idea that Sam and T'Challa should be buddies, like they're, you know, they shouldn't be fighting. Now my sort of galaxy brain response to that is that Sam has for so long been a support character, a secondary character, that in order to kind of level him up,
right,
he needed to be to,
right.
Yeah, in order like if he's T'Challa's friend, then he's the friend that people right, like T'Challa right. more.
If he's always in agreement with everybody, then it's easy for him to fall back into the support role. Right.
Right. But if you create the tension between the two characters where they're not always on the same page, then it kind of elevates him to the same level as T'Challa. You know, and I think that's important.
Stand apart and kind of elaborate on his perspective. Right. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think that's going to happen a lot more in the Avengers book, where it's like by having like two black characters, like that are not a block, you know, like T'Challa and his boy Sam. You know what I mean? It's like, no, we are two separate black characters that have different ways of seeing the world, and are both equally valid. Like I think that there's a world in which a year from now, Sam is maybe not as respected as T'Challa, but at least kind of on the same tier of prominence.
Well, I would absolutely say that the effort is very real to try to get Sam elevated as a character. I can definitely feel as though they're trying to like push him, you know, not like in a sort of try hard kind of way, but in just like they're really diligently trying to find where he fits in, what best suits his sort of, you know, who he is as a character. And I respect the effort. I just like, I want that solo. Yeah. I really do.
I mean, I think the solo is coming for sure. I mean, I don't know exactly when it's coming, and all that was sort of as a setup for the possibility that maybe they're waiting to announce like a major name on the Sam Wilson solo, kind of the way that they used to do that with T'Challa, you know, Black Panther. It's like nothing. And then boom, Ta-Nehisi Coates is writing. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, I don't think they're gonna go back to Ta-Nehisi Sam, but I think that they could have someone else of similar, you know, stature and prominence writing a Sam run as a way of kind of announcing that he's a big deal.
I mean, Eve Ewing, Stephanie Williams.
Oh, no, I was definitely thinking of someone outside of the comic box, like someone that's like.
Well, I mean, hopefully it won't be like a novelist or something like that. Because if so, that was like sort of wasn't that the same struggle that they kind of had with Ta-Nehisi when he first came in? Like, they were like, okay, well, you have to sort of be trained to reframe the way that you tell the story so that it's not so novel-y. It feels more like a comic, right?
Yeah, but I mean, while that's true from a quality standpoint, from a this is a big deal,
yeah,
in the mainstream standpoint, like I think it was very good for Black Panther to have someone of that stature writing the book. Do you have thoughts on this, Carlos?
I'm trying to think of like if like Marvel announced like Jordan Peele is writing the new Sam Wilson book. Okay. Yeah. I might be interested in that. Yeah. I might be interested in what that looks like, you know?
Yeah.
Is that the right character? I mean,
Jordan Peele.
The reason that was the name that came to mind, but right. I was like, I don't know if that's the right character for him, but it might be. I have no idea. Maybe he's got something to say.
Yeah, I mean, there's names escape me right now as far as like someone who has that kind of mainstream cachet. But I think that having someone with that kind of mainstream cachet being announced to write a Sam Wilson Captain America book would be huge for elevating the character. You know, and I could see Marvel going that route, particularly given what we said before about, you know, T'Challa not being an MCU character, and them wanting to sort of complete that step of letting people know that Sam Wilson's in the A-list.
Yeah.
So, you know, even though I know you're a little bit worried about him in the later parts of the season, putting up FCL numbers, I think that there's a potential, you know, for a step up in prominence in the character, like, you know, from a news perspective.
Yeah. Are we sure the book is ending? We know Sentinel of Liberty is ending. Are we sure that Symbol of Truth is ending?
I'm just finding out about this through Randy. So yeah. I would have to do some research, but it's possible. I mean, it's, you know, both of those books are leading into this event.
Right.
So
like I've seen headlines of like articles that are like, Sentinel of Liberty is ending, leaving Steve Rogers without a solo book. And it just seems weird that there aren't like, and also Sam Wilson won't, you know, is ending. Right. That's not in the article, you know? So exactly. I wonder if we're assuming it's ending because the dual, you know, Sentinel of Liberty and Symbol of Truth.
Right. Exactly.
Because one is ending. I wonder if we're assuming the other is ending or if there was an actual announcement, because I haven't seen that announcement.
I recall seeing something. Like, okay. I knew that somebody was coming on, Straczynski was coming on board for a new Steve title. And then I think it was like, I think it may have been something like sort of an addendum or whatever that was saying, like, you know, that would be the only one that basically we knew of.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if both books were ending just because of the sort of symmetry of like one being Symbol of Truth and one being Sentinel of Liberty. But I could also see a relaunched like Sam Wilson Captain America book that has its own, you know, that has its own team and has its own ethos that's not two halves of a whole, you know? So
I hate to say it because, like, you know, I definitely root for a Black writer to be the one next takes it up. But, like, I wouldn't be mad if Nick Spencer came back. Ooh. He did really good.
I agree.
He did really good. So I would, like, he's one of the few, like him and for some reason, if Jed Mackey would deign to do that, then, you know, but, you know, other than that, I'm hoping that it's somebody black who'll be next.
So like I said before, my first choice would be someone from outside, so someone with a prominent mainstream name to sort of announce that, you know, that Sam Wilson is a big deal. As someone who spends way too much time on Twitter, I don't want Nick Spencer by himself because I don't want that kind of discourse.
Exactly. It's like that's my personal appreciation of his title, but then the Twitter discourse of it all. So yeah.
Exactly.
I'm
But if
just
they
like
could
racking my brain for like who is that outside of comics
like
or something.
I literally
Listen,
have nothing to contribute there because
no,
I don't really read novels like
it's
that. So.
Barack Obama is the answer. It's like Barack Obama writes, like in his comic book debut, Barack Obama writes Sam Wilson.
You know what? It wouldn't shock me if his daughter did. Isn't she like a Hollywood, like in training person?
She is, but I don't know if she has any like interest in comics. Like I feel like Barack has like at least occasionally said pro comic stuff, and he was in a
So
Spider-Man comic.
you want the right to like absolutely hate his comic.
Oh.
like you want to like to his comic is gonna be like on the headlines of the hatred.
Yes, because they were going to do that anyway. Like
No, but I'm saying like
it's going to lead every segment on Fox News. It's like
exactly. So I'm saying like we have like okay, as part of the segment, they sometimes talk about Captain America, you know, their little off color, not knowing what they're talking about comics and stuff. You want them to be like, and for this show, for this hour, we are going to be talking about how terrible.
Yeah, I haven't figured out how they're going to work woke into the discussion, but yeah, like it might as well lean all the way
Captain
into
America, A New Awakening.
it.
Oh man, I just pictured like Michael Eric Dyson
Yeah.
writing Sam Wilson and just like using like just unnecessarily long words. Just being like, all right, we get it.
Yeah.
You know words.
Yeah, we don't want that. That's what we don't want. That's what we don't.
Donald Glover? What would he have
Is
to
he a
say?
writer?
Donald
I
Glover?
mean,
No,
He's
I mean
yes.
like it, I mean a
Like a
comic
comic
writer,
writer.
not science. Yeah,
He's
right.
never, I don't think he's ever written a comic. Do I think he could? Yeah, I think he could write a comic.
I kind you see again, if Donald Glover was going to write his first Marvel comic, I'd kind of want him to write a either Spidey comic or a
Prowler.
Prowler comic, or a disc, or you know, or a Hypno Hustler comic, of course.
Right.
The return of the
I
hip.
actually wouldn't mind seeing him write like Miles Morales. I really wouldn't.
No. I just thought about it. Spider-Punk.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. I can. I mean, yes. If it's not going to be him finally putting some flavor on Hypno Hustler, then fine. Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Did you say finally putting some flavor on Hypno Hustler as if Hypno
Like
Hustler was
as
someone
in
we knew?
like as in bringing him like actually giving the black context, not like people sort of using him as a punchline for like we hate disco.
I see.
Yeah.
Oh.
What?
It's Questlove. Questlove is the person who'd be like, oh, and Questlove's writing the new Sam Wilson comic. You're like, really? Interesting. Because white people love Questlove.
White people do love
We
Questlove.
love Questlove.
But I still feel like he's too like music, and not enough politics. 'Cause you want people to be like, oh man, they're really gonna get into the relationship between black people and society. You know what I mean? Like, not to say that Questlove doesn't have that in his
Oh,
oeuvre.
so it's Dave Chappelle and
No.
We don't want
No, let's not do
anti-trans like transphobic Sam. No.
like he can't be anti-Semitic. Like that's
Yeah.
specifically a deal breaker.
Man. Okay, I guess fine.
Yeah, we'll brainstorm. We'll come back. We'll come back, listeners.
We'll get it.
We'll get it together. But as of now, I mentioned before, only 80% approval for this Anthony Mackie so fan far. Cast so far. Yes, 60% strongly approve, 20% somewhat approve, 6.7 somewhat disapprove, and 13.3% people who are fans
anti-black.
It's the Chinese. People who review bombed The Little Mermaid also review bombed Anthony Mackie as Sam Wilson.
Yeah.
And that takes us to the Latinx delegation. Talk us through Reed Richards, Mr. Fantastic.
I wanted Moon Knight and he was gone. And I wanted Sam Wilson and he was gone. And I wanted Cyborg and he was gone. And so then I took Reed Richards. This is the latest I think Reed Richards has ever gone in our draft.
Yeah. Well,
because usually a first or second round pick, maybe.
Well, because people realized it took them long enough to realize that Reed Richards is a bit of a reach.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's not getting solo comics, he's part of the team.
Correct.
Well, I mean, it wasn't that much of a stretch. it wasn't that big of a stretch back when when Slott was it Slott? Yeah, I think it was Dan Slott that was writing the Fantastic Four comic, the 2018 Fantastic Four comic. It was like 48 issues in. Yeah. So it was like you knew monthly is coming through. And then on top of that, that was like around the time when they sort of had their little sprinkling of a beef with the X-Men and like
that was a good point.
So it's like they had the X-Men and Fantastic Four little crossover thing. And it's like
typically the Fantastic Four plays a part in Marvel events, you know, like Empire. Yeah, but I think that traditionally, the early round picks are characters that are not exclusively in team books. I think that people have gotten savvy enough now to know that, like, even a prominent character that you see around a lot, if he's not or she, you know, is not in a solo book, probably not going to put up a lot of put up a lot of FCL points and not going to show up that much in media without the rest of their without the rest of their crew. And because of where we are now, where the Fantastic Four hasn't yet been cast, maybe we'll get a Fantastic Four casting this summer. I'm not mad that you didn't hedge your bet with his name.
I'm still thinking about it.
No. I was talking to Carlos about
Johnny Storm.
No. I'm forgetting.
Oh, you're saying Diego Luna is the
Diego. Man. Yeah, thank you, Diego Luna. Like I don't think he's actually going to be cast. I mean, you know, but I think he's
definitely not going to be cast, is what I would say.
Yeah. But he is in the conversation. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he's been in the conversation, and I think that like purely from a people were really hyped about him as potential casting. Probably could have earned you some little extra sprinkling of approval, of approval for that. But yeah, I would not be surprised if at least two of those castings that have been rumored end up coming to pass this summer.
I wouldn't be surprised if all four of them get announced at Comic-Con or whatever there is.
I sure hope so.
I sure hope so too, because I would like some points.
Aside from the points, like I'm ready for the discourse to like at least come to a head.
I'm kind of sick of the fan casting.
Yeah.
At this point, the fan casting is so like not creative. It's just like, all right, whatever.
Yeah. I mean, but like even creativity aside, like they've run through every possible different configuration of who the heck could be Reed, who could be Sue, who could be Johnny, who could be Thing. Like, good God, let's get it over with.
Exactly. That's I agree with that. But you know, for the benefit of
but... cast Ezra Miller.
As no,
we cast them as Herbie. That's who we cast them as. Mm-hmm.
But the for the pick, you were saying,
right? So I was going to say that for the benefit of our discussion, though, talk about how, in your conception of the character, whether sort of Latino Reed, both from like a casting perspective based on your Rodrigo Santos casting, but also from just kind of a canon standpoint, what you think could be like additionally brought to the character as Latino Reed.
So actually this is something where like there isn't really anything to me that says that Reed necessarily has to be white in their backstory, maybe in their personality. The idea of like only I can save the universe and only I can solve this problem. Yeah. Is kind of a white thing, but there are white people in Latin America.
Yes, there are.
As the LA Times has just discovered. Right.
And there are white people who like come to America and are like, you know, if we even go with like the traditional kind of like 1960s sort of like idea of whiteness and idea of Latina, mm-hmm. that, you know, like a Reed, forgive me now for what I'm about to say, like the Ricky Ricardo like of it all, you know, of where it's like, yes, you're a Latin lover, but you're also light enough that we accept you into the fold, you know, but maybe every now and then your accent comes through.
Every now and then, Ricky Ricardo. Yeah, I don't think there's anything that would necessarily change with Reed being Latino in the backstory. You have him be a wealthy Brazilian who is afforded the ability to go to boarding schools and the best, you know, universities or whatever, but is also smart enough to get into those spots and is, you know, is brilliant. And yeah, I don't see any bump really in making the character Latinx.
Well, like I said, and to me the other piece of it is that because he, you know, based on the fan cast, like could be a white guy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like some of the perception of him, you know, you don't have to worry about him being thought of as less than in the same way that someone who was maybe more visibly brown would need to kind of overcome the perception that he wasn't valid as the smartest man in the world.
Right.
Like it would be one of those deals where like, I didn't know you were like,
right. Yeah. You know, I didn't know. And then it wasn't until I was like looking at the fan casting, I didn't know he played Xerxes in 300.
Oh, yeah.
I had no idea Rodrigo Santoro was Xerxes.
You know, so, a different haircut, beard, switches it up. Like
he definitely can switch it up. He can look at times, he can look Persian, obviously. Xerxes. But he can also, he's got the, he's got like, I don't know, it's like he's got like a like melanin activate when it's time to his tan is very Latino, but he can, if you didn't know, you would just like, he looks kind of Keanu Reevesy, where it's just like, you're definitely white, but there's something else in there.
Exactly. Got a little sprinkling of this, little sprinkling of spice in your in your otherwise. So yeah, I think it works, honestly. I like you said, I don't think there's, other than the kind of often the criticism, the Reed Richards, like, I'm the smartest man in the room, I can solve everything, ego thing. But
and also his tendency to sort of bump heads with the mutants. Not too heavily, you know. It's not like, you know,
look, he just doesn't want his, he just doesn't want his son,
don't get too close
to, he just doesn't want his son to make the wrong choices,
right? Don't want him to get mixed up in the wrong crowd. Not that,
yeah, he's come too far in America, you know, and gotten so close to privilege. He doesn't want his son to fall in with the, you know, with the wrong kind of people, you know.
I mean, and also, like, ask a dark-skinned Brazilian person if they think white Brazilians think they're better than them.
Exactly.
Okay?
Right.
See what happens.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, I think it could work. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a win in my book for the Latinx delegation. Right now, I didn't mention the approval rating. 75% approval rating for Latino Reed, 50% strongly approved, 25% somewhat approved, 12.5 somewhat disapproved, and 12.5 racist. And for the fan cast, 77.7 with 44.4 strongly approved, 33.3 somewhat approved, 11.1 somewhat disapproved, and 11.1%. You just mad because he can steal your girl.
That's the other thing too, is like, he's a great looking guy. And yeah, if the Fantastic Four is like a famous group, like if they're celebrities, you know, like people know them, he'd be the face of that. And
yeah, for sure.
Looking, and he looks like Reed Richards. He just kind of does look like Reed Richards. Honestly, I think he looks more like Reed Richards than John Krasinski.
Oh,
you know,
he looks. Yes. I mean, again, we've talked about this before. Reed, I don't think Reed has to be like ultra handsome.
Sure.
But I mean, is, John Krasinski is ultra handsome.
Oh, no. No, I don't let me get on my Jonathan Krasinski soapbox. The man only is chosen because he has a beard, which makes him look like 90% of other white guys with beards.
Right.
And
right.
Has a wife.
Yeah.
If he didn't have a wife, how many people would be fan casting him as right. Reed Richards?
Like, I mean, he didn't even give that at all. Like, I mean, did he even have the white hair streaks? Is my question. I'm trying to remember.
No,
he didn't have the white hair streaks. So
no,
it's like,
he did not.
For what?
I would say this too. It's not even that he has a wife. It's that he has a white wife who could feasibly be Sue Storm in a movie. Like,
oh, yeah,
right,
yeah,
exactly.
That's
could I take her without him? Yes, I could take her without him.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. People were like, Emily Blunt would make a good make a good Sue Richards, you know, and her husband too, who has a beard, like Reed has a beard.
Right.
And,
yeah.
And they don't
if John Krasinski was married to like Megan Thee Stallion, first of all, something would have happened. That would have been number one sign that we're in a simulation, but no one would be like, oh, Reed Richards.
Yeah. No. Or if they, or if tomorrow they were like, yeah, they're having marital problems and they're separating, like half the fan casts would go away.
I don't know. I think the horse is out of the barn on that.
They just crumble up their bingo cards in rage.
Yeah. Can you just imagine like, fuck, just like tearing. God damn it.
They were a package deal. You know.
Now, and then they just move on to like Dax Shepard.
Exactly.
Dax Shepard and Kristen Bell. Here we go.
Oh, there's another married couple. Yeah.
Ashton exactly. Kutcher and Mila Kunis. That one's actually probably out there.
I don't even want to look.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't, I've bait other than the fact that he's not as known of a commodity as these other actors, I wouldn't have a problem with the casting on, you know, the work that I've seen. And it would be a little bit against type because he usually plays like more action oriented people, but I'd give him a shot, mostly because I know it's not from that silly place. It's because he's got a wife.
He's been in tons of stuff too. Like for not being like a quote unquote like name actor who gets like brought up for stuff. He's in like Love Actually. That's 20.
But he's in Love Actually?
He's the guy that Laura Linney has a crush on in Love Actually.
Damn. And
like, yeah. That everyone in the office knows that she's in love with him and whatever. I watch Love Actually every year at Christmas time. It's like my Christmas movie. But
it's a great movie. I just
that's 20 years.
Skips a couple Christmases.
He was in Charlie's Angels Full Throttle 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's been around.
Yeah, if you wanted to go the direction of Hot Reed, you could do worse than Rodrigo Santoro. So, yeah, I'm here for it. It seems like the audience is here for it, but not all the way here for it. But, you know, shocking. There's still time. There's 4 days for somebody to get acquainted. And then that brings us to the final pick of the round, the Jewish delegation drafting a character that it has really been sitting on the board for way too long, if we're being honest. And that is Raven, Rachel Roth, not always Rachel Roth, but Rachel Roth here. But, you know, she's been canonically Jewish. She's also kind of been headcanoned as a woman of color, but not always canoned.
I mean, as best as I can recall, they had her more coded rather than ever explicitly in it. Like, I think because, you know, obviously I don't keep up with sort of I didn't read her solo comics, but I read the Teen Titans, New Teen Titans, you know, different runs, and I don't recall them ever having said that she is Indian.
Yeah.
Native American. So it was like, you know, sort of she has things here that are supposed to be like physically reminiscent of that, but never anything explicit.
Well, yeah. So I think what it was that her character design was that was based on an Indian actress. I can't remember now, because that was like a controversy that happened a few months ago when, you know, most recently she was depicted as very Caucasian something.
Yeah, like she, they've sort of been at it for like ages, because you have the fact that she has the, I believe it's called a bendy. She has a thing on her forehead that is like, you know, people think automatically of like third eye, the bendy, you know, that's sort of an Indian thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then also we had sort of the counterpart controversy of like the casting of Jinx and like the whitewashing of that character. So it's just, and then even over in, trying to think what it was. It was a Multiversity Team Justice that had the male equivalent of Raven, who also is named Raven, but he's like native, I believe. I believe he's indigenous.
Yeah, so and I think that there was a version. There was also a native Raven in, I want to either, I think it was Earth One in that like run, like multiverse run. Like I think that like there have definitely been versions of Raven where she's been more explicitly a woman of color and coded as Native American. So I think that's been in the ether, but it's you know, it hasn't been canonized.
Yep.
So but, you know, traditionally, like her name, when they do want to get into it, it has been Rachel Roth, you know, who is, you know, her mother was Jewish. That's generally how that works. And I think that in terms of the fan cast, I think that the Jewish delegation was smart to sort of square the circle with a Jewish, an Israeli actress who kind of is a little brownish.
yeah.
Odea Rush, I'm not familiar with her work, although I think I have seen her in some in a couple things. But as of now, from an approval standpoint, they're sitting at 92.8 for the pick, 71.4 strongly approve, 21.4 somewhat approve, and 7.1 somewhat disapprove, and 100% approval rating for the fan cast.
Yeah, I had to give my little bump to that poll, because just the howl of anguish that I imagine Toriano let out when he saw that cast. I was like, yes, that is glorious. Bravo. Very well.
So yeah, I mean, I think it works. I think it's, you know, the canon is intact. I think in terms of still imbuing the character with some of that like brown skin energy. you know, like I think you can have people, skin. You can have people being like, "Are you?" Like, it's like, oh yes, my father is a demon. There it is. there's that person of color. That's where it comes from. That's where. So you know, all the hatred can just get funneled right through the fact that her father is a demon. So yeah, I mean, there's not that much to be said. I don't want to go into the realm of Kanye West. but that's the week, man. That was our 10th pick. That was the round five. I thought round five was really strong. Round six, we're going to get to the halfway point of the main draft. This is where things get interesting. This is where, you know, drafts can get lost. People can fumble the bag. You know, I'm very curious to see what happens in the coming week.
I predict a lot of bag fumbling, because it's really tough. Like, we got, you know, we are trying to pick characters, and especially us toward the end, hoping we don't get like left with scraps and stuff. But then on top of that, we can't really do anything in terms of like the dynasty characters unless we want to like risk, you know, putting them up on the board again. So it's mm-hmm. it's definitely going to take a lot more consideration than it did last season.
Yeah, I mean, I like the, you know, we've talked about this. I love the idea of the dynasty characters, because you know, you want these characters long term, mm-hmm. but you know, if some of those guys are out there and they're, you know, being elevated at the moment, you know, you could feel tempted to try to get these like short-term points, but then next season you put them back into yeah. the pool to get drafted.
I definitely see one or two who I'm like, might need to take them out of reserves.
Yeah, but you know, strategically, you know, you guys know this, but I'm for the benefit of the other people in the draft, you know, strategically you have every incentive to save those picks for the end.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
exactly.
You know, so
yeah, I know who my 12th round pick is. That's about it.
But yeah, I mean, I you know me, I like when people come up a little bit outside in the second half of the draft, for sure. I like when people kind of go outside of the box with a character that you might not have expected. Early on, probably not, you know, this is where you want to get your, you know, your core characters. But once we start getting into like the 8th, 9th, 10th rounds, that's where I really want to see the creativity and the, you know, the interesting angles of how these characters can be reinterpreted and reimagined. So yeah. I'm looking forward to that for sure. But
wait, this just hit me. Jewish Raven says Azarath, Metreon, Soros.
Oh no.
Okay.
Oh there. No, no, we yeah. can't. That is
now let's go ahead and skip to the portion where we tell everybody what our ad is on Twitter.
Exactly.
I am at MTF. I. Yeah, she has that incantation, and then lasers come from the sky.
Oh wow. We really, really did take it there. Luckily, most people haven't made it this far into the podcast.
Jared, I know you did make it this far. I want you to know you can have that. It's all yours.
But yes, you can find me at MTFIII on Twitter, but you can find the podcast at Racial Draft Pod on Twitter. You can also please support our website, racialdraft.com, where I am diligently trying to keep all of the picks and all of the pictures, you know, the visual references and the polls and everything in one tidy place. If you don't feel like scrolling through social media, but you can still find us on social media. You can find us, if you subscribe to us on YouTube, you can find us on Instagram at racial.draft. Or on Facebook, if you're still doing that thing, speaking of Soros. and yeah, where else can they find us? You can give us money. I like money. On Patreon. You can do that, Racial Draft on Patreon. Where can they find you guys? Randy?
I am on Twitter at RandyS0725, and I use the hashtag SuperPowerList.
And Carlos?
I am at Carlos Freitas Jr. on Twitter, and you can find my writings and ramblings at agentsoffandom.com.
Nice. And like I said before, MTFIII on Twitter. I should have also mentioned you can also email us at racialdraftpodcast@gmail.com. If you want to have your email read on the podcast and you're not too racist, you know, I give a little leeway, like give or take 5% racism, you know, so I can indulge a little bit, but go ahead.
Death threats encouraged.
No, not encouraged. Death threats are not encouraged. but you know, I always you know, we mentioned this before. If you're a disapproval voter, we love to hear your explanations as to why you're disapproving, because it, you know, helps us kind of build out our conversations. So
in fact, we shouldn't even count your disapproval unless.
In fact, we will count your disapproval double if you explain your disapproval. No, we won't do that. I don't want that math. I don't want that math on my plate. yeah, we'll leave it there. Tune in next week. Same race time, same race channel, where we will talk about the possibly problematic Transformers Rise of the Melanin Beast. we'll also still be talking about Spider-Verse, because classic movie. But until next time, all things are possible.